it's in the order of 14. It is a very highly infectious virus.
A leading financial advisor says the central bank's investigations into the tracker mortgage scandal are not over. It's emerged a further 1,100 AIB customers have been overcharged interest on their mortgage with the bank's subsidiaries EBS and Haven. Over 40,000 borrowers were caught up in the controversy since news of the overcharging broke in 2015. Last year, Permanent TSB was fined €21 million by the central bank for its involvement. Mortgage broker and debt advisor Michael Dowling says fines are still being issued to other lenders.
We've only had one bank fined at the moment, that's Permanent TSB, for what went on with the tracker scandal originally. All the other banks have made provisions for anticipated fines from the central bank, but the central bank hasn't issued fines to the other banks as part of the initial investigation. So the work of the central bank is not finished.
And finally, commemorations are being held in Bosnia today to mark the 25th anniversary of the Srebrenica massacre. Over 8,000 Bosnian men and boys were killed by Serb forces in what's described as Europe's worst atrocity since the Second World War. The events to mark the occasion have been scaled back because of the COVID-19 pandemic. And that's your news at 2 minutes past one.
For the last few months, Suzuki dealers have been stuck at home like a lot of us. In Cork, Jane has broken her personal best for the 10K. And in Dublin, John has started yoga. But now they're back and ready to help you to get going again with unmissable offers across the Suzuki range, including the new hybrid Vitara. For more details, contact your local dealer. Suzuki, helping you get back on the road.
News Talk Weather.
Thanks to the AA. Download the new AA app to request a roadside rescue and track the patrol right to your car.
Today will be a mainly dry day, cloudy to begin with, but long spells of sunshine will develop, becoming hazier towards this evening, and there's just a risk of isolated showers in the north and northwest. Highest temperatures of 16 to 20 degrees. And now you're up to date on News Talk.
We've had some great days and great nights and good memories. I hope that the people of Ireland have got... I know that they've got the memories. I know they cherish them, and I know that they've enjoyed the days that when they've done something that they've never done before. They go to a World Cup as part of it a couple of times. They've enjoyed that, and the European Championship.
Thank you for the days, those endless days, those sacred days you gave me.
The president phoned me and said, would you like, the job is yours if you'd like it. And I said, I would like it. End of story.
I won't forget a single day, believe me.
Well, you know, we're 28-1, I think, we're quoted as, and we're not expected to do anything in this competition. We just hope to surprise a few people.
This kick by Sanselin goes Aldridge, and Houghton! 1-0!
Nowadays, you see, they've changed it. Everybody in Europe does a little bit of what we did. Everybody in Europe. But they've changed the name, the FIFA guys. They call it pressing. Because they don't want to tell us that we started it. We call it putting people under pressure.
Malta 0, Republic of Ireland 2. And history has been made in Malta. Jack Charlton achieving his victory. Achieving his ambition.
We've qualified for the Go to Italy and we've done it ourselves. I'm absolutely delighted, not only for me, for our lads and for all the fans.
The nation holds its breath. Yes, we're
there! And then I saw David coming, and I'm not the greatest believer in centre-backs taking penalties. And then David went back, put the ball down again, and went, sent the goalkeeper on way and put it in, and it went fantastic.
We're there. We're in the last eight for the first time in my history, and it's magic. I'm delighted for the lads. And good luck to the people back home. Right. Hope they have a good part.
Dern came to me, and he said, our boss, he said, when we get to Rome, this you'll get us in to see the Pope, won't you? Well, that was where the final was going to be played, and I don't think they had a prayer again for the final.
Right.
We prepared properly. We had a little bit of sun. We ate well. And we drank very little. We're going to change that tonight.
It's a bit like religion, isn't it? And football's a bit like religion, isn't it? And Jack's... He'd be like a sort of, I suppose, he'd be like a pope or a bishop or something.
He would.
But easy, onto it comes Houghton, and Houghton with a shot, and it's there! Yeah.
I went into the players and we just sat in the dressing room and we were getting changed and everything. And then somebody come and said to me, would you come out back on the pitch? I said, what for? He said, the crowd won't go home. I just remember, I just cried. It was time for me to leave. I'd been there for 10 years and it was time for me to leave. And I did.
Yeah, it's a sad day on Off the Ball Saturday on News Talk here. John Duggan with you through till 5 o'clock. Really sad day for the nation. Jack Charlton has passed away at the age of 85. His family confirmed the passing of the former Republic of Ireland manager, who had been ill for some time. A statement has read, Jack died peacefully on Friday the 10th of July at the age of 85. He was at home at Northumberland with his family by his side. As well as a friend to many, he was a much adored husband, father, grandfather and great-grandfather. We cannot express how proud we are of the extraordinary life he led and the pleasure he brought to so many people in different countries and from all walks of life. He was a thoroughly honest, kind, funny and genuine man. He always had time for people. His loss will leave a huge hole in our lives, but we're thankful for a lifetime of happy memories. We also, at All To Be Sports, Off The Ball, News Talk, we really express our deepest sympathies with Jack's family and friends. It's a really sad day for Irish sport and the Irish nation. He managed the boys in green for over 10 years from 1986, as you heard in that great montage. He led us to Euro 88, the World Cups of 1990, 1994. Before all that, he was a World Cup winner with England in 1966, a league and FA Cup winner with Leeds United as well. He's survived by his wife, Pat, whom he married in 1958. There are three children, John, Deborah and Peter. We'll be paying tribute to Jack Charlton all the way between now and 5 o'clock, speaking to a range of personalities, chiefly those who played for the man from Northumberland, who won all of our hearts. So we'd like your memories, your stories, listeners, by being involved in our conversation today with our text messages. 53106 is the text number. You can also tweet us at Off The Ball. We were all part of Jackie's Army. We want to hear your memories and your stories today of that great time with Jack Charlton. And we're joined on the line now by the former Republic of Ireland manager and player to start off the show, John Giles. John, good afternoon. Very sad day. It's been a tough while for you, John. You lost your former Leeds United teammates, Norman Hunter, Trevor Cherry, and now Jack. You knew Jack for over 50 years, so we're really sorry, John, for you, for the man you knew so well. Your teammate at Leeds and the former Republic of Ireland manager. A tough day.
Yeah, it's very, very sad. It hasn't been well for a while, John, you know, unfortunately. But condolences to Pat. Pat, his wife, is a lovely, lovely girl and knew her well in Leeds and got on very well with my wife. So it's a sad day and he's had a full life. There's no doubt about that, Big Jack.
Big Jack. And Euro 88, Italia 90, USA 94. He helped put football in this country on the map, John. He led us to some great days, wonderful days.
Yeah, well, the first time we qualified for a major competition. And in Ireland, like other countries, we'd love to be on the big games and the big competitions. And it was great for the country, 88 and 90 particularly. First time we ever qualified for a major competition. So I think Jack popularised the game in a way that had never been popularised before. I mean, people in Ireland who, had, in my opinion, didn't have that much interest in soccer before because the country got there, followed them all the way and definitely popularised the game in a big way.
Do you remember when you first met him, John?
I remember, Jack, when I first met him. I went to Leeds in 1963. I was 22. Jack was, I think, 27, 28. And I actually had a strip next to him in the dressing room. So I met him when I'd met him before that because he's a brother of Bobby, the famous Bobby, as we know.
Yeah.
And he used to come to Manchester now and again to see Bobby. And I met him there in Manchester. But I didn't get to know him very well. Obviously got to know him very well when I went to Leeds at that time.
And you effectively took on the establishment with Leeds, John. You won the league in 1969. You won the FA Cup in 1972. I say he was a great man to have behind you because he was a great centre-half.
He was, he had a strange career, Jack, at Leeds. Before, Leeds mostly were a second division team and they were in the first division now and again. And they weren't doing very well when Don Revie took over. And Jack hadn't been the best trainer in the world. He didn't look after himself as well as he might have done. And I think Don Revie gave him a warning that if he didn't book up, he'd be out. and he became then the best centre-half, in my opinion, in what was then the what's now the Premier League, for at least five seasons. And that included playing in the World Cup, winning the World Cup with England in 1966. He was a top-class centre-half.
What was he like as a teammate?
I didn't get on very well with him as a teammate. We had different ideas about the game. Jack was a big centre-half, and he saw the game through the big centre-half's eyes. So if Bremner and myself were going deep for the ball, he'd say, get up the pitch. I can do what you can do. And then he'd kick it into the crowd. He believed that, in other words, if he got the ball on the edge of the box, as a big centre-half, it was a good chance he'd lose it. And he saw the game through that way. Like, he wouldn't give any credit to Billy Bremner and myself as little fellas who could beat somebody and wouldn't lose a ball at the edge of the box. So we didn't have the same philosophy on the game in a big way. But we respected each other. He was the best centre-half, as I said, for at least 5 or 6 years in the First Division. And off the pitch, we got on very, very well.
A good character, loved to pint, loved to fish. And I think that's what people loved about him. He was just a very authentic man. What you see is what you got.
Oh, yeah, that was Jack. There was no two sides to Jack, as they say. You know, that's what he was. He could mix well. He was a great after-dinner speaker, John, by the way. He was terrific at it. You know, he's very natural. I don't think Jack ever suffered with nerves on anything. You know, he just was what he was. He got on with anybody. He was the total opposite to Bobby. You know, Bobby was a very shy individual. Bobby would go into, say, into a pub. He'd be always sitting in the corner. And Jack would be up at the bar talking to everybody. No bother to him. He was a very, very outgoing individual.
So by the time we qualify for these tournaments, John, you're in the RT studio. It's strange that you're a teammate of this man, and then you're the manager, and then he's managing us to a European Championship and a World Cup, and at times you had to be critical.
Well, I think when you're doing the job, if it's no point in doing the job if you're not going to say what you believe. I'd say I wouldn't be very popular at the time criticising Jack when the team was doing well. But it was an honest opinion. I always respected him. We were total opposites in our philosophy on football from the time we played together. But I think Jack respected my situation, and I respected his. I didn't agree with everything you did. But if you go on the television and you honestly don't agree, and then you start agreeing with him on the television, people spot that very, very clearly. So I respected Jack. I didn't agree with a lot of the things that he did at that particular time. And I'd have to say and people used to say, well, I might be jealous about him because I didn't qualify as a manager. But I'd have to say there were different situations from the time I was a manager to Jack was a manager. In other words, Jack had a huge and bigger and better selection of players than I had. And I don't mean any disrespect to the players I had, because the granny rule changed. We called it the granny rule for people who qualified for Ireland. And a few things changed. First of all, in my time, you have to top the group to qualify for a major competition. In Jack's time, it went to second in the group and then later on to playoffs, which was a big change. And the granny rule changed, where we got the likes of Ray Houghton, Andy Townsend, John Aldridge, these type of players, which made us, I think we had terrific players, really, really top-class players when Jack was manager of the Irish team. And he did a great job with them.
And Euro 88, beating England at Stuttgart, that was just... That was a landmark day, John, in Irish football, wasn't it?
Which is that?
Euro 88, beating England at Stuttgart.
Oh, yeah. It was huge. Well, England were always the big enemy for us, and to beat them in a major competition. First of all, to qualify for the major competition, and then to beat England, I think, in one of the early matches, was it really got the crowd behind the soccer team in Ireland that hadn't been there before.
Just read out some text.
And Jack did that.
Bear with us, John. Let's read out some texts here from the listeners on 53106 about Jack Charlton. The crazy thing about Jack is we tend to forget over here what a player he was, but Big Jack in Ireland was a match made in heaven. I really feel we were lucky to find each other. He'll be sadly missed. Jack was a gentleman through and through. I grew up in Moy Heights in Ballina, County Mayo. Jack bought a house there in the early 1990s. He spent many weeks there during the summers enjoying fishing, which was a real love of his. A mark of the man was that he agreed to take part in a Q&A session to raise funds for the local residents association. He was probably the most famous man in Ireland at the time, but he happily obliged, had his few pints of Guinness and was very accommodating. Rest in peace. It's no overstatement to say Jack Charlton and his teams helped the country to start believing in itself and helped find a new confidence. Rest in peace, Jack. That is from Pat in Cork. A truly remarkable man that a whole country knew as Big Jack. He changed Irish football, but he was also part of a process that saw the Irish nation begin to have confidence in itself on the world stage. Thank you for everything, Jack Charlton. Rest in peace. Lads, we should all wear the green jersey today to salute Jack. The first time I saw my old lad cry was when he got to Euro 88. The King of Ireland, that is from Neil in Bray. And as long as Euro 88, Italia 90 and USA 94 are visited, as long as leather is kicked in the football pitches of this country, as long as those lucky enough to have been on the journey live, we will remember Jack Charlton because he made our childhood magical. I really do think, John, that the journey, whoever was the leader, whether it was Jack or any other manager, football to me in Ireland is now the number one thing. The Republic of Ireland team is the number one thing, and that is because of those tournaments.
Oh, there's no doubt. I mean, we love being on, like any country, we love being on the world stage. And Jack put us on the world stage for the first time in 88 and then 90 and really, really did the job and did it well. And he was a great character as well, as some of the people who are writing into you now. Like, Jack was a very ordinary lad. He was nothing big-headed about him at all. He was what he was, what he came from in Newcastle from the early days. He never changed. And he was a good human being.
Good stories that you remember, John, of Jack?
Well, there was quite a few. Jack was always... There was Jack and the rest of us.
Right.
You know, Jack was older than us, and Jack was... Jack was Jack, and he was a bit older than the rest of the lads, and he was captain of the team for a while and didn't like it. He had the superstition that he'd like to go out on the pitch last, and I think it was a relief for him. I don't think he enjoyed being captain, but he had a good sense of humour. He mixed in with the lads, and we had a good time together. We had a great time. I got on very well with Jack, very well.
Italia 90 was just. I got the feeling with Jack's teams, whether it was luck or whatever, that we always seemed to find a way for a while. The Romania game, the penalties, then we're playing Italy, the hosts in Rome. It was just this journey, this roller coaster. You didn't know when we were going to get off, and we finished in the top eight in the world.
No, it doesn't happen by luck, John.
Yeah.
It happened because Jack gave us great leadership. Again, I would say I didn't agree with everything about football with Jack, but what Jack did do was definitely a leadership. In other words, Jack knew what he wanted. He insisted on it. He didn't take any... Because a lot of players, like I know, didn't enjoy the way we played under Jack. And a lot of players with managers don't understand and want to play the way the manager plays. And some managers give in to it. And that's lack of leadership. There was no question that Jack would give in to anybody in the way that we played. This is the way it was going to be. And this is the way we were going to do it. And that's what he insisted on and got the players to buy into that. And that was great leadership.
And great man management as well. The likes of Paul McGrath, he got the best out of Paul.
Yeah, he got the... Yeah. Well, you know, it wasn't always good. I think his managership of Liam Brady wasn't good. His managership of David Leary wasn't good. But that's... By the way, I don't want to be critical of Jack, but that's an actual fact. But, I mean, he got the best out of the players that he had available in the team, the players that he put in the team. They bought into what Jack wants to do, and that's what got us where we did. Because if you don't have leadership, you're not going to do well. And he did give us that leadership.
John, it's, I suppose, a really sad day. We can talk about the football as much as we want and this and that, but ultimately we're remembering a great man today who's passed, Jack Charlton, a man who brightened up the lives of so many people in this country, and that's not an insubstantial legacy.
No, I would... Well... I played with Jack for 10 years. I would regard Jack as a very, very good friend. I saw him fairly recently, and despite the fact that I might have been critical on television of Jack and his football philosophy, that's by the way. I never fell out with Jack. Jack never fell out with me, and we remained good friends up to. Well, the last time I saw him was probably about 7 or 8 months ago, and I've always regarded Jack as a very, very good friend, and condolences to Pat and the rest of the family, and a very sad day for the family.
Well, John, we're sorry for the loss of your friend, and we look forward to speaking to you on Off the Ball again. Thanks.
Thank you.
John Giles there, back after this.
Off the Ball on News Talk. Back on Track with Bobby Kerr.
Back on Track is the new weekly podcast where we find out how businesses have coped, how some have thrived, and how industries are adapting. This week, it's all about food. From manufacturers to distributors to consumers, we'll hear from the experts right across Ireland.
Back on Track with Bobby Kerr. A new podcast from News Talk.
Thanks to Bank of Ireland.
Listen and subscribe to the podcast now at newstalk.com or on the News Talk app.
At Renault, we want to be the first to bring you Buy Now, Pay Later. Our new 3-2-1 offer gives you three unmissable reasons to buy a new car. Three, that's 3 months real deferred payments. Plus two, 2.02% APR. Huge savings with Renault Bank. Plus one, 1,000 euro cashback. Yes, you get all three. Buy now, pay later from Renault. Visit your local Renault dealer today. Offer is made under hire purchase agreement subject to lending criteria. Terms and conditions apply. See Renault.ie.
Oak Park. Real rashers rediscovered. Discover our high-protein, low-fat Oak Park turkey rashers.
Get away from it all this summer and escape to Offaly. Step back in time at Clonmacnoise Monastic Site. Cycle the Grand Canal Greenway and explore the wonders of science and nature in Burghcastle Domain. Let loose on mountain bike trails or hike it in the stunning Slieve Bloom Mountains. Discover nature, culture and fun activities at Loch Borah Discovery Park. The great outdoors really don't get much greater. Peace and quiet an hour from Dublin, Offaly is Ireland's hidden gem. Click visitoffaly.ie to discover more.
From teaching them how to ride a bike to brushing their teeth, life lessons really matter. Teaching kids about money is one of the most important. That's where Ulster Bank's Money Sense can help. An online hub with free interactive content to help kids aged 5 to 18 make sense of money. It also has great tips for parents on how to equip their kids with positive money skills that can last a lifetime. Search Ulster Bank Money Sense today. Ulster Bank. Help for what matters. Ulster Bank Ireland DAC is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
Looking for a top quality mattress that is 100% Irish designed and Irish made? With dedicated sleep experts to help find the best mattress for you? Well, this weekend, get to the Harvey Norman 4-day mattress clearance, where you can get Irish made single mattresses from just €89, 800 pocket sprung mattresses from just €299, as well as massive deals across all the biggest brands, like half price O'Dearest mattresses, discounts across the entire King Coil range, and more. Harvey Norman Mattress 4-day clearance, now on.
Go! TechFinder gives your business access to thousands of IT contractors globally on one direct platform. Browse thousands of professional profiles. Create job postings. With a no-commission policy, TechFinder's subscription platform does the work for you. Join now as a company or contractor at techfinderwithay.com.
Local community pharmacies across Ireland have remained open throughout the COVID-19 crisis, putting new measures in place to keep everyone safe and healthy. We would like to thank all our customers for your kindness, cooperation and understanding of the changes we have had to make. What hasn't changed is the quality of care we provide, supplying the medicines you need and the advice you trust. Your local community pharmacy, always here for you. Brought to you by the Irish Pharmacy Union.
Well, the world's gone mad if you ask me. Every dog and his mother heading for the park or the beach, forgetting about the home and all it's done for us recently. No fur off my back. The AA helps me there, looking after house and contents, freeing me up to work on my swimming stroke. That doggy paddle isn't as easy as it looks, you know.
For added peace of mind, when you're working from home, the AA provides cover for home office equipment. And right now, you can get €60 off your home insurance when you purchase online at theaa.ie. Who's got clever home insurance? Minimum premium of €218 applies. €60 off online. New business policies only. Acceptance criteria, terms and conditions apply. AA Ireland Limited Trading as AA Insurance is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
The switching revolution continues at Carphone Warehouse, with deals you won't find anywhere else. Get the Huawei P30 Pro and a GT smartwatch for just €49.99 on a €40 month plan with Vodafone, now with unlimited data, but only when you switch at Carphone Warehouse. And get the brand new Samsung S20 5G free when you switch to a Vodafone €60 a month plan with unlimited data. So get into your local Carphone Warehouse store and join the switching revolution today. T's and C's apply. Offer subject to availability and 24-month contract.
At Guaranteed Irish, we believe enterprise is at the heart of thriving communities.
Did you know Gempack Foods have been making baking a piece of cake for the people of Ireland since 1967? Based in Damastown, County Dublin, they've been providing Ireland with gem baking ingredients that are good enough for granny for over 50 years. Guaranteed Irish welcomes companies that are altogether better choices for our communities. So look out for it. GuaranteedIrish.ie. Altogether better.
The Saturday panel on Off the Ball.
Well, this is Off the Ball Saturday on News Talk, and we're breaking regular programming to bring you an extended special to pay tribute to Jack Charlton. The former Republic of Ireland manager has passed away at the age of 85. Very sad news today for the nation. We'd like your tributes to Jack. Send in your memories of being a part of Jackie's army and how the success of the Republic of Ireland team impacted your life. Getting some through here on 53106. Lads, I was 19 years old for Italian 90. What memories? Not ashamed to say, I shed a tear this morning when I heard about Jack. Rest in peace. That is from Jack, another Jack in Walkinstown. I say a man who might have shed a tear as well today is Jason McAteer. Jason, good afternoon.
Hey, John, how are you?
Yeah, tough day, Jason.
It was, mate, yeah. Obviously got up this morning and you know, you look at the phone, don't you, see what's going on, and had a couple of random texts really breaking the news, to be honest. And then you're right, you know, a few tears were shared and, you know, absolutely devastated, to be honest. I think it's a bit more prevalent because we've been doing quite a few documentaries over the last probably 6 months with a couple of companies in Ireland, and you know, been reminiscing about times, and you know, Jack was very much at the forefront of those documentaries and the stories, so it was all pretty fresh of all their memories, and even, you know, just catching up with the lads as we do. As you know, we're very close, Aldo and Ronnie and all the Irish lads, Ray, and you know, we always ask, has anyone spoke to Jack? How was Jack? And you know, it was just I'm still not over it, to be fair. I feel a little bit broken, to be honest.
Yeah, sorry, Jason. What was he like as a man?
I think, you know, he's such an imposing figure. He's got this aura. He had this aura about him. Like, you know, when he walked into a room, you knew he was there. Big, imposing figure, 6'4". Sure, the accent, as you know. But, you know, when he spoke, everyone listened. But, I had a great relationship with him, you know, John. I always felt he had a... You know, I always thought that was one of his favourites, to be honest. I know it sounds mad, but he used to, like, give me this wink and smile at me all the time and put his arm around me and stuff. And, you know, I really felt like a strong bond to him, to be honest. I was only with him as, obviously, manager in 94, and then he finished around 96, didn't he? So, you know, it was only a few years, but obviously he stayed in touch and stuff. And, you know, he was just top man, mate. He was just, you know, I remember him giving me a... You know, a few times he called me to his room. You know, one was to, I remember the two significantly ones was when the World Cup in 94, when he called me to his room and told me I was playing against Norway and not to be messing around and get some sleep. And that was a special moment. And remembering all the lads thinking Guinness in the room when I knocked on the door, that was funny. And then the other one was when I just sort of come into the squad before we went to America. We had a couple of friendlies and I remember he gave me a start and I knocked the ball inside a couple of times. I remember him going mad on the touchline. And then we got back to the hotel. I got a call. I was getting ready to go out with the lads. I was ironing my shirt. And I got a call. And it was a Jack saying, come down to my room. I want to speak to you. And I went down. He gave me the biggest rollicking, John, just about passing the ball inside. You ever pass the ball inside for me one more time? He said, that'll be it. You won't play for me again. You've got to take it on board. You've got to be quick. And I was like, yeah. I was quite upset because, like, to be told off by the manager, then Jack was one thing. And then he just went to me, just give me a cuddle. He went, enjoy your night tonight. Like, and just walked off. He just had a big smile on my face, and I just bounced out of his room. But he was just an infectious character, and he was a real man's man. You know, you could go to him and talk to him. His door was always open, and he was just a lovely, lovely fella.
That's a great insight into the psychology of man management, isn't it? And just how, as a guy who was just earthy, that was able to get the best out of you. A kick in the backside and a pat on the back at the same time, and
exactly.
that makes you a lovable guy, you know.
Mate, I mean, you know, the most successful managers are, you know, are all well equipped in the man management role of the job, and Jack was, you know, second to none. You know, he had a way of playing. It was difficult for me, you know, to play his kind of philosophy and tactics because I was, you know, from Liverpool where you don't give the ball away. You know, keeping the ball was paramount, but Jack was. You know, you get it, you pump it up the pitch 60 yards and you get up behind it. I mean, in some ways, You know, we talk about the high press now. Jack was doing it back in 88. You know, the high press, pump the ball up, win the ball in an area where you can hurt people and get in the box with a big man or whoever it was. And, you know, that was his game, and it worked a treat. But some of us did find it difficult. But, you know, he'd give you time. He was patient with his players. And yeah, it was just an absolute privilege to be around the squad from obviously 94 going to the World Cup and up until 96. 96 was sad because, you know, he knew he was on his way out. He knew his time was up. You know, to rejuvenate a squad was going to be very difficult around that time. And it was sad. The Holland game at Anfield was really, really sad. You know, it was a sad night. But, you know, just being around, you know, the squad from 94 and going to the World Cup and being with them and listening to the stories of the lads, what they tell from 90 and 88, you know, it was just brilliant. He's a sad loss, mate. He's a big loss.
And also change people's lives, Jason. People who go to the Giants Stadium will never forget that. Irish people.
Exactly, mate. I mean, it's not just what he did for us on a personal level. It's what he did for Ireland. You know, the economy boomed from what the squad were doing around that time. You know, just the way he handled people, the way he was. And let's not forget, he won the World Cup for England. You know, I mean, winning the World Cup is one thing, but then managing a different country and having been from England, it was going to be tough enough. But he was quickly taken on board. He quickly won people around. And, you know, people then, you know, he was Irish, wasn't he? People don't look at him any other way now. And we used to laugh and joke and say he could be Prime Minister of Ireland, no problem. You know, he'd get all the votes. And, you know, he was that infectious and people loved him that much that he could run for that role, and I'm sure he'd do a good job at it. But yeah, I mean, he's just loved. He's just loved all over, just not just in football, but in life.
Yeah, and before you were called up, Jason, in for 94, I doubt you would have dreamed that what have happened to you did happen with the World Cup in the USA and that. And Jack had a big part in that, making you feel welcome and feel part of it.
Absolutely, mate. That's why, you know, I'm so devastated, you know, for someone like Jack to leave an imprint on my life that he did. You know, it's going to take a while to get used to it, but it is what it is. And, you know, it's sad, but yeah, I mean, the day, you know, I got asked to play for England and I wanted to play for Ireland. And when Bruce Rioch made the call, you know, Jack came down and watched me play against Everton in the FA Cup. I'll never forget it. You know, I knew he was at the ground. I wanted to impress him. And then I went into the players' lounge and he made a beeline to me. He was with his son John at the time, and he made a beeline to me. I was with my mum and my nan, and he came over. He just said, "I want you to represent the Republic of Ireland against Russia, Lansdowne Road." And I was just overcome. Like, it was just, not only is that Jack Charlton, but I've got my opportunity. And, you know, although I was never really likely to go to the World Cup in 94 due to a couple of injuries and, you know, Jack wanting to inject a bit of youth into the squad with me, Gary and Phil, you know, we had to work hard in the games that preceded the tournament. And, you know, the Germany game over in Hanover, where he was so made up with the three of us. And then, you know, I think it says in his book that we booked our place on the plane after that game. He made his mind up he was going to take us. And then just the way he handled us, you know, I actually didn't think I was going to get any chance of playing in that World Cup. I thought, you know, number 21 and, you know, being in that squad, I just thought I was going to be, you know, there for the ride and enjoy it and get some experience. But then when he tells me you're going on against Italy, you know, to have faith in a young lad that had been playing for Marine non-league football 3 years previous, and he wants to throw me on against Italy in the World Cup on the biggest stage, you know, just tells you how much faith he had in me. And I wanted to repay him, you know, and I'd run through a brick wall for him. And, you know, and then I started the game against Norway. And, you know, to have them memories as I got older and talk about it and reminisce just puts a smile on my face. But it's definitely tinged with sadness today, mate.
Was he, I guess he was exactly the same in the dressing room, Jason, as what you'd see on TV or in any interviews, that it would just give the instructions, what you see is what you get. Was that the case?
Oh, mate, that's him. That was Jack. You know, there was no air and graces. It, you know, he had something to say, he'd say it. You know, he was an emotional guy. You know, he was very emotional. And, you know, the way he treated us and as a squad and as men, you know, as footballers, you know, it just, his training sessions were just a joy. And to be fair, John, I tell you what sums it up. You don't have to play for your country. It's an honour. You know, you get asked to go. You don't have to go and play. It's not like a club where you're contracted and you're paid and that's your job. You know, it's a great honour and it's the greatest honour to go and play. But, you know, a lot of players don't get on with managers or they don't want to play for one reason or another. We could not wait to go and play for Jack. Mick McCarthy was the same. We couldn't wait to get on that plane and fly to Dublin and go and play for Jack and spend 5 days in each other's company. And, you know, that's a testament to how he treated us, that we couldn't wait to get there for him. You know, we used to join up on the Sunday. We'd have a couple of pints in the bar, and he'd come in, and then we'd have a night out. We'd all get together, camaraderie. And then Monday would be the pitches. Tuesday, we'd have an early night. Wednesday, we'd go and win. No, we'd win a lot of games under Jack. Thursday, we'd fly back to our clubs. And we used to say to each other when we were together, like, we're gutted we're not a club team. We were gutted that we weren't playing in the Premier League as a team, because it was just the best time. It was just, you know, we had the best squad and the best manager. It was, I'm absolutely devastated.
And you wouldn't have had a Robbie Keane possibly or a Damien Duff in the team and these young players coming through like John O'Shea without the legacy of Italia 90, USA 94. And that's what we need in the country, isn't it? We need to be getting to World Cups like Jack did and giving the young lads inspiration.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, it was a golden generation of football for Ireland, and thanks to Jack and the players involved, you know, from 88, you know, beating England, and then 90, going to Italy, quarterfinals, you know, unfortunately getting beat by the Italians, but it was glamorous, wasn't it? It was, everyone was watching us. And then 94, England obviously hadn't qualified, so we were everyone's favourites. And, you know, as young kids growing up, you know, I was a big Liverpool fan, so obviously all going Ronnie and Ray and Stan, everyone playing for Ireland, I was always watching Ireland. So, you know, it was very fashionable, and it was a great team, and you could see the team spirit and how the lads played and the camaraderie. So obviously, being a footballer, lucky enough, I wanted to be a part of that. But obviously, like you just said there, you know, as generations go, you've got to aspire to wanting to play for your country, but you want to be doing it in World Cups and in major championships, and that's where we aspire to be. And, you know, the manager is a big part of that, because, like I said, you don't have to go and play. You know, you've got to want to go and play, and the manager breathes that in the squad, and you've got to want to go and do it for him and run through brick walls, and that's what certainly Mick and especially Jack had.
Did you keep in touch with Jack much over the years after he left?
It was difficult, mate, because obviously his health was deteriorating over the last probably, as far as I can remember, probably, you know, 5-8 years. I've always remembered people, you know, when I ask about Jack, saying, oh, he's not too good, or, yeah, he's on the mend, or he's taking a step backwards. It's always that kind of answer, really. But we had a reunion, I think it was about 18 months ago, we had a reunion and everybody turned up and Jack turned up, and obviously you could see, you know, he'd aged, you know, he was 85 years, isn't he? So, you know, he would have been around 83, 84, but he was frail, he looked frail, but he still had that grin, he still gave me that cheeky wink, and, you know, that lit it up for me, that, you know, that was a very special moment. But it was just testament that the people that went, everyone who got the invite was there because they all wanted to see him, because obviously he was up in the northeast and he didn't venture out much because of his health. But, you know, that night, you know, everyone turned up because they knew he was going to be there, and, you know, he turned up, he didn't let anyone down, and it was just amazing to see him. But I can tell you now, mate, every time you get together with one of the lads, everyone will say, have you spoke to Jack? Have you found out? Is Jack all right? You know, it was the first thing on everyone's mind. Whenever we got together, everyone wanted to know how he was.
Well, Jason, you're an absolute gentleman to join us on Off the Ball Saturday here on News Talk, and sharing your memories with Jack on a very sad day.
Yeah, cheers, mate. Thanks for having me on. Thanks,
Jason McAteer there joining us, and we'll speak to Kevin Warren shortly. Just coming through some of your texts on 53106. And at Off the Ball on Twitter, hi lads, one of my fondest memories, my mother, now deceased, is during the Romania game of 1990. She had no clue whatsoever about football, but got caught up in Jackie's army that year. We're all sitting in the sitting room watching the game. We were all tense and quiet. My mother broke the silence by saying, why the hell do they keep kicking it over the bar? We all just burst out laughing. She then got the rosary beads out for the shootout, a cherished memory that would not have occurred without Big Jack. RIP, that is from Baz in Longford. Aaron Nolan on Twitter, would be great if Off the Ball could mention the side of Jack Charlton beyond football. He was a founding member of the Anti-Nazi League in the UK during the 70s. He stood with striking minors in the 80s. He wasn't just a football man, he was a working class hero. Frank O'Rourke, the sense of pride he gave us is unthinkable now. The country was on its backside, a load of emigration. He gave us a huge lift. Great memories, RIP, big man. Conor McManus remembered the 1994 World Cup as a 6-year-old and all of the colour, the passion, the happiness of Ireland being at a World Cup. None of that possible without Jack Charlton. Also converted my parents into fans. They had to drag the sandpit into the living room to keep an eye on me during Italia 90 games. The simple fact we didn't have to accept the moral victory in sport or identity. We were in fact masters of our own destiny. And Nev Walsh here on Twitter, celebrating my 14th birthday on my own, in my head, in my hands, afraid to look at the penalty shootout against Romania. Parents in the pub, siblings nowhere to be seen, acceptable in the 90s. We're paying tribute here to Jack Charlton, who has sadly passed away at the age of 85. Joining us on the line now, very much delighted to be joined by Kevin Moore. And Kevin, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, John.
Tough day, Kevin.
It is indeed. It's a very sad day. You know, I think I did know Jack wasn't well, so, you know, what happened today was inevitable. But I tell you what it does too, you know, as you've been listening all morning, it brings back the memories, and the memories of what Jack has done, not only for Irish football, but for the whole country, you know. And I think that'll be his greatest legacy as far as the Irish supporters are concerned, of what he did for everybody. And I certainly was delighted to be part of it.
Do you remember the first time you met him, Kevin?
I do. I remember the first time was when we went on a trip to Iceland. It was the first tournament we had. I'd missed this first game, which was at Wales. We played Wales at home. I'd missed that. And therefore, the next game, I think, was that trip to Iceland, which was the first tournament we ever won in some regards, even though it was only three teams in it, Czechoslovakia and Iceland. And that was it. I just met him at the airport. And everything was just so easygoing with Jack. You know what I mean? There was no big scene as regards meeting you or whatever. You just blended in with everybody else. He just about said hello to you as well, really, you know. But he was so easy to get on with, you know. And because I can remember a good story as regards that, going over to Iceland. I'd been there a year or two before with Manchester United, and I'd remember that you couldn't get any drink on the island inside. They wouldn't sold it. So you had to get it at the duty-free going in. And I'd mentioned this to Jack going through, and he said, sure, go ahead, get some beers, you know. And I just thought, how easygoing is that? Here's the manager you're just meeting, and they were going through the other side with some beers in our hands for the after celebrations of after the games.
He gave you guys a lot of belief, I think, Kevin. You'd had a close run in 82 with Owen Hand and that, but the way you played, whether you agreed with it or not, you bought into it, and you qualified then with Gary Mackay's goal for Scotland against Bulgaria, and then it all just started.
It did, and you're right. I think a lot of us might have been a little bit sceptical about it in the beginning. It wasn't what we expected to do. We had a lot of good players. We thought we could play a little bit more than what Jack wanted to. But he had a way he wanted us to play, and that's what defined Jack as well, was how strong that leadership was, and this is how I want you to play. You play it this way, or you don't play for me, you know? And we bought into that, and as a result of that, the success came. You know, and success in winning games, you know, things that hadn't happened before. And all of a sudden, then you qualify for the Euros. And, you know, it really all started from there, really. So you bought into it. It was successful. And it's all down to Jack.
And a dressing room with Jack and Mick Byrne and everybody after beating England must have been unbelievable in Stuttgart.
Well, to me, I still look back as being one of the biggest highlights of my career, that beating England. The first major tournament you've qualified for, you know, it's the Euros, 88, and it's the first game as well against England. You know every single one of the players you're playing against. Some of them you're playing with. You know, you're with them in the dressing room at the club level. And here you are playing in the biggest game ever, and we go and win it. And it just doesn't get any bigger than that, you know. And I must admit, even though, you know, you look at Jack Charlton played for England on 35 occasions, won a World Cup for them. And he was as Irish as you could be that evening when we beat England.
That qualifying campaign for World Cup 90, I remember Spain coming to Dublin, Kevin, and they were, to me, as just a young lad watching on TV, they looked frightened.
In some ways they were, but I think they were even more frightened when they went out for the warm-up on the pitch, because Jack had made sure that the pitch wasn't cut, that the divots that were still in place from the rugby game that was probably played the week before were still there. And the pitch was an absolute nightmare. So believe me, when you've got these, you know, great silky players from Spain coming over looking to play nice, attractive football, Lansdowne Road was not the place for it that particular evening. And, yeah, they looked a bit scared when they came off after the warm-up, believe me. And the way we played as well didn't exactly help.
The World Cup of 1990 was just an unbelievable occasion for everybody involved. And I say by that stage, you felt a huge amount of confidence in yourselves under Jack's leadership.
It was, you know what I mean? In some ways, it's a pinnacle because of the fact that here was the first World Cup we've ever qualified for, you know. And then not only that, it's getting past the first stage, you know, that was an achievement itself. And then you move on, you go through the penalty shootout with Romania. Everything was just one adventure after another adventure. Then going into the quarterfinal, you're playing the host nation, you're playing in Rome. Like, as you say, just the whole nation was behind us. So when you listen to people even now this morning talking about it, I think that is what, to me, Jack's legacy will be about. It's not just about football. It's the way the whole country, you know, came behind him, came behind the football team, and the good that it did for everybody. You know, it just just united everybody so much.
Do you remember any kind of messages he was given at the time in those big games against Romania before the shootout or against Italy in the dressing room?
He was never one for big messages. You know what I mean? He was one very much, you know, he'd make the point as regards what he wanted you to do, and then he left you get on with it. We used to have our own little talks ourselves as regards, come on, we've got to do this, we'll do that, we'll do the other then as well. And what typifies that to me would be after Romania, when it goes for the penalty shootout. Right, he comes out into the middle, gathers everybody around, and he says, OK, we've got a penalty shootout. Go sort it out yourselves. And he walked away. You know? Now, not many managers would do that. You know, and therefore, we were left. There's no problem. If somebody else said, Andy Townsend said, I'll take the first one. And somebody else said, I'll do this and that. And it was all sorted out in no time at all. But, you know, that was Jack. You know, he'd done his work beforehand. He knows, we all knew how we had to play, how he wanted us to play. And he just let us get on with it.
Just speaking to Jason McAteer there, Kevin, about that everybody just loved joining up with the Republic of Ireland team and playing for Jack. It's almost like you caught lightning in a bottle. Did you feel the same way?
It was, you know, and I don't know whether you realise that, but he gave us a lot of freedom, you know what I mean? He allowed us to, you know, explore, express ourselves and get out and have a bit of fun, you know what I mean? We weren't locked up in a hotel room or anything like that. He didn't like it, and he didn't want us to have that either, really. So, you know, and I'm sure Jason would have said this, there were guys on a Saturday after playing a club game, and they could have a hamstring strain, a little sort of a niggly thing, and 9 times out of 10, You know, people would try and get out of an international game for other countries. We'd often hear that in the club dressing room. Oh, he didn't want to play against them. It might be a friendly game at home to Cyprus. You know, who wants to go for that? But we all did. We all wanted to come because of the fact that the fun and the camaraderie we had between us, which Jack allowed to develop, which manifested itself as well, by the way, onto the pitch. He allowed that to happen, and that's the reason why there was such great fun among all the players. And, you know, we just enjoyed meeting up so much.
And changed supporters' lives, people's lives in this country. I know we're going to be talking about
indeed.
That for the next 4 hours, but it's because it's the truth.
Well, it is the truth. You know what I mean? You know, people are talking about the memories they have, you know, how much they it invigorated them. You know, you're talking about, you know, steadfast people that were just, you know, GAA through and through, rugby through and through, would never look at a soccer match. We're just enthralled by these matches. They were watching these games. You know, you've got old people that would never have an interest in football. They were on, you know, sitting down, you know, watching them on the box and watching what's happening and taking part. And the whole country was talking about it. So that's how much it did for us. And that's how much Jack did. And, you know, that's what he'd be remembered for.
As a Dublin legend, did you ever bring him to a Gaelic football match, Kevin?
I didn't. I never actually brought him to one, but he has been to Crow Park, I think, on a number of occasions. You know, and I think he really enjoyed it. I think he was surprised by the vastness of Crow Park itself. You know what I mean? Which is always a bit of a shock. You know, as I was the other way around almost when I went from Crow Park to Old Trafford, the first time running out onto the pitch, just to see it and view it, not to play it even, I was shocked by how small it was. So I've no doubt that he would have been shocked by how big and how vast Crow Park is.
He was great crack, Kevin. He was a great character.
Oh, 100%. You know what I mean? And he allowed us, as I said, to express ourselves, to have a bit of fun. You know, he allowed us to have a drink. You probably heard the stories about us chanting, Jackie, give us a drink, and stopping the coach and stopping off into a pub on the way home from training or the way home from the races, I think, on one occasion. You know, and he allowed these things to for us to get on with. But you know why? Because he enjoyed it himself. He loved it.
Yeah.
he loved being in the vicinity of the players as well. He loved the banter that we all had together, you know. And so he allowed that to develop, while at the same time, which is the most important thing at that level, getting the success as well on the pitch.
And football as well, being put in the shop window and the front pages and the back pages, I do think it changed the way the Republic of Ireland team is viewed. I would still see the Republic of Ireland team as being the biggest thing in the country, played soccer across the country. When you look at the TV numbers, Kevin, it's still the top show, the top draw, and I think Jack has a lot to do with that.
Well, there's no doubt about that. You know what I mean? If you think about it, the number of kids, young kids, you know, it's the easiest game to play, you know, when you look across the whole country in terms of, you know, population-wise, kids playing football. You play soccer, it's so easy just to play at that early age. Probably at later stages, you know, the GAA probably come more into play and more professional in terms of the organisation of it, which is obviously better than what the FAI has been. But overall, yes, during the era of Jack, you know, he literally brought it on to another level, you know, for people to go out and enjoy themselves.
Have you seen him much in recent years, Kevin?
The last time I saw him was when Niall Quinn is due here. He was fantastic, Niall, when he organised, you know, a reunion in 88 for 30 years from 88 on at the K Club, and we had a fantastic time there. And what was great about that, it wasn't just the players from 88, it was some of the players from 90 as well and later on. And, you know, that was at the time we saw Jack, and even though he wasn't great, but he was still able to, you know, see everybody and communicate and get on with everybody as well. So I must admit, you know, what Niall did then was absolutely brilliant, and it was great for all of us players as well to get together and have that camaraderie back again together. But even more so now, when you look back, you remember how good was that, that we were able to see Jack then.
I think it's just to finish, Kevin, the legacy that a man who had a very firm view of how the game should be played, made it work, brought us to places we never thought we would get to in our lives. World Cups, top eight in the world, the Giant Stadium, like to pint, like to fish. An adopted and honorary Irishman has left an incredible legacy on a very sad day.
Yeah, absolutely, John. You know what I mean? As I said, you know, it's a sad day, but he's had a great innings. You know, you look back on Jack Charlton's career, you know what I mean? Highlight has got to be, you win a World Cup in 1966, we'll always be remembered for that. You know, he played for one club, Leeds United, over 700 appearances there. It shows his loyalty, you know, as well. And then he comes over here and becomes an honorary Irishman with the work and what he did for the Irish football team as well. Hey, he may be gone today, but he'll always be remembered.
Lovely words. Kevin Moran, thanks so much for speaking to us today and Off the Ball Saturday here on News Talk. Kevin Moran,
okay,
there,
thanks,
joining us here to pay tribute to Jack Charlton's memory after he passed away at the age of 85 today. Very sad news. We're speaking to Mick McCarthy after the news at 2 o'clock. 53106 for your text messages. Add Off the Ball on Twitter to pay tribute, your tributes to Jack Charlton. Just read a couple out here. Sad day for Irish football. The day we drew 1-1 with Holland, we ended up in Terracini outside Palermo. The square was alive with Irish fans celebrating our qualification. Suddenly, from the corner of the square, Jack appeared. To this day, I think there was a glow around him as he strolled through the masses, parting before him like the waves parted from Moses. He was our Messiah, and we loved him. That is from Eamon in Cork. I met Jack at his first training session with Ireland at Dublin Airport. He spoke to us all watching, and he was particularly chuffed the FAI bought him new boots. A World Cup winner, but so down to earth. He was different. He was a real hero. The nation held its breath, but today we shed tears for Big Jack and his family. I'll always cherish the memories he gave this nation. Much love and respect. That is a beautiful text there on 53106. Only this week I went and bought the 1990 Irish jersey. The pride in showing my kids the jersey and telling them about the era. All made possible by Big Jack. Rest in peace. And Anne-Marie Hart, June 1990, attempting to study for Intercert Geography whilst watching Ireland-Romania penalty shootout. 4 years later, got sacked from the summer job in Pizza Hut in Leicester Square as I chose to watch Ireland initially. Still have the T-shirt. 53106, we're speaking to Mick McCarthy about Jack Charlton after 2 o'clock.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. When you've watched more Belarusia Premier League than is healthy, proper football is back. Gamble responsibly. See dunlewy.net.
Petrol, diesel, hybrid, plug-in hybrid, electric, which one do you choose? At the Society of the Irish Motor Industry, we're here to help. We know different drivers have different needs, so we provide clear, simple advice on the benefits of each technology. Whether you're buying a new 202 or a used car, talk to your local SIMI retailer. Drive cleaner, drive greener. To find out more, visit simi.ie/drivegreener.
TechFinder gives your business access to thousands of IT contractors globally on one direct platform. Browse thousands of professional profiles. Create job postings. With a no-commission policy, TechFinder's subscription platform does the work for you. Join now as a company or contractor at techfinderwithay.com.
Afternoons are easy with InsureMyVan.ie, Ireland's low-cost van insurance specialists. Get your business back on the road with InsureMyVan's best price guarantee. For super savings, visit InsureMyVan.ie. City Financial Marketing Group Limited, training as InsureMyVan.ie, is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
From the apartment in the city to the cottage in the country, at Energia, we're the power behind 250,000 customers across Ireland. And right now, there's never been a better time to join us and save on your electricity and gas with our cheapest dual fuel bundle. Wherever you're living, know you always get the biggest savings by coming direct to us. Go direct to energia.ie and switch today. Energia, the power behind your savings. EAB €1,364 based on average annual usage, 12-month contract, discounted unit rate, standing charge, PSO levy and carbon tax, T's and C's and early termination fee apply. Valid from June 2020 and subject to change. Verification and T's and C's at energia.ie/EAB.
You know that feeling you get when you sense a team's winning streak is about to end? Or when you know the pundits are getting it all wrong? That feeling? That's me. I'm your hunch. I was there back in Istanbul when you just knew the comeback was on. I'm the guy that tells you when the odds don't look so odd. I'm your hunch. It's time to start listening.
Heed your hunch with Betway. Download the app to find out more about Betway's Bet Club. Full terms apply. 18 plus. Dunlewy.net. Bet the responsible way.
On Thursday, July 16th, from 5 to 7 p.m., National College of Ireland is hosting a virtual open evening, where our lecturers and admissions team will be live online to answer questions about our wide range of full and part-time courses. To register, call 1850 221 721 or visit ncirl.ie.
In this week's Sunday Times, we celebrate hurling's golden age in a special supplement reliving 25 years of brilliant action. From Clare's breakthrough to Kilkenny's dominance and the revival of Limerick and Waterford. Pick up a copy in-store or subscribe to our €5 a month, 7-day digital package at thetimes.ie/join.
The country is on the way to reopening, but the world and our roads have changed since we were last out here. There are now more of us cycling and more of us walking. And there are more reasons to look out for each other. Drivers, please slow down and take care when passing pedestrians and cyclists. Pedestrians, always walk on the footpath. If there isn't one, on the right-hand side of the road facing oncoming traffic. We're on the road back. Make it a safer one. A message from the Road Safety Authority and an Garda Síochána.
Check this out. Super Value are cutting their prices again. Super Value Irish Whole Chicken 1.6 kilo, now €3.99. Super Value Salmon Darns 240 gram, now €3.99. And Super Value Irish Rooster Potatoes 2 kilo, now €2.79. Check out Super Value's fresh price cuts for yourself. It's got to be Super Value.
It's time for a spring clean this summer. It might sound odd, but it's been an odd year. Your car was probably locked down like the rest of us. For summer, get our new Audi sanitization service. For just €289, you'll receive an Audi service. Plus, we'll replace the pollen filter to keep the cabin air clean. And our special sanity treatment kills the germs in your Audi. It's not too late for a spring clean. Book your service at audiservice.ie or contact your local Audi dealer to arrange an appointment. Terms and conditions apply.
On 106 to 108 FM.
On newstalk.com.
On smart speaker.
And on the Newstalk app. This is Newstalk.
It's
It's 2 o'clock. Good afternoon. Tributes have been pouring in for the former Republic of Ireland manager Jack Charlton, who's died at the age of 85. President Michael D. Higgins paid tribute to his legacy of outstanding leadership, which captured the imagination of the nation. The Taoiseach has described him as one of the great characters of the football world, while the FAI says he was the manager who changed Irish football forever. These people in Dublin say Big Jack provided great memories.
I think it's terrible. I think he done great things for Ireland.
Very, very sorry. I only heard it on the bus when I was coming into town that he had died. I couldn't believe it now, you know.
Jack Charlton, he was one of the best for Ireland. I mean, he's incredible, the guy. It's sad to see. It's a sad loss.
The reopening of pubs on July 20th could be delayed over fears of a second wave of COVID-19. It follows scenes of large crowds drinking in Dublin last weekend, coupled with a recent rise in cases among young people. Gardaí are continuing checks on pubs and restaurants this weekend to ensure compliance with public health guidelines. Dr. Ray Wally from the GP Expert Advisory Group is warning cases could easily rise again.
If you have 10 layers of meeting people, one person could effectively infect 56,000 people. Now, you apply that to something like flu, and that's in the order of 14. It is a very highly infectious virus.
Meanwhile, a cluster of COVID-19 cases that arose from a house party in County Kerry is being investigated by the Department of Health. It's emerged a group of people in their 30s, most of whom are from Dublin, travelled to Killarney last weekend. They stayed for a number of days and partied in rented accommodation, according to a letter issued to GPs. The group aren't believed to have visited other congregated settings, such as pubs. At least one person has since tested positive for COVID from the suspected cluster. A man in his 60s has died in a house fire in County Galway. Members of the fire service and Gardaí attended the scene at Moyla at around 5 a.m. After the fire was brought under control, the man's body was found inside. The scene has been examined and the local coroner has been notified. Gardaí say foul play isn't suspected at this time. And that's your news at 2 minutes past 2.
News Talk weather.
Thanks to the AA. Download the new AA app to request a roadside rescue and track the patrol right to your car.
Today will be a mainly dry day, cloudy to begin with, but long spells of sunshine will develop, becoming hazier towards this evening, and there's just a risk of isolated showers in the north and northwest. Highest temperatures of 16 to 20 degrees. And now you're up to date on News Talk.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. When you've watched more Belarusia Premier League than is healthy, proper football is back. Gamble responsibly. CWE.net.
Well, we're joined on the line here on Off the Ball Saturday on News Talk to pay tribute to Jack Charlton, who has very sadly passed away at the age of 85, by the former Republic of Ireland captain and manager Mick McCarthy. Mick, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, John. How are you?
Not too bad, thanks. Mick, a sad day for the country.
Very sad. Yes, I mean, we all knew that he'd been unwell, Jack. I had breakfast with Tony Cascarino the other morning, which was a nice surprise. I bumped into him, and he said to me that Jack was really unwell. And I spoke to him just after his birthday, and desperately sad news today to hear that he's died. But you know, he's been having a long he's had a long illness now.
How will you remember Jack, Mick? He gave the country some marvellous days as Republic of Ireland manager.
I remember him as the bloke that gave me the best time of my life in football. That's how I remember him. I knew him before. I used to have a pint with him in the Red Lion pub, and so I'd become friendly with him. I'm saying friendly with him. I was in awe of him. He was nice to put to ladies in him.
Like, you were already an Irish international.
I'd worked with Norman Hunt and Alan Clark. And then to get with Jack was just, he was fabulous. And he made me as a player, and I said he gave me the time of my life as a footballer over 88 and 90. It was wonderful.
You were an Irish international before he came along. What do you remember of your early interactions with him, Mick?
When he first came into the job.
Yeah.
He made it plain and simple what he wanted. And I know he sometimes gets remembered as this long ball game, but he was very tactically aware, Jack. And he was the one that turned a team of, a group of good players into a team that was a real force to be reckoned with, and a team that qualified for 88, 90, 94, or the country that did. But he galvanised the team. He made it simple. He knew what to do. He knew how to do it. He knew what the opposition didn't like. And he simplified it. And it just made it, I said he turned some of the good players that we had into really great players, international players.
I think the day that kind of put us on the map, Mick, was Euro 88 in Stuttgart when we beat England. And from that moment on, I think we always kind of felt as supporters, and I don't know about you as a team, that we'd always find a way to win or to get through.
Yeah, the team spirit was incredible. The willingness to work for each other, the togetherness. And that was, I mean, Jack created that, and that was with him, but that was with the country as well. That was with the fans. You know, the sense of belonging to that squad and to that team and that time of the fans and the country was just amazing. And he turned it around. I heard a fella today who was 16 back in 88 when we beat England, and he was saying, born in Ireland, he was saying how it transformed the country, it galvanised the country. And I thought, well, I've been saying that for a long time, but it was nice to hear a guy now who was 16 then and him saying it. He was living in Ireland.
And a bloody good team as well, Mick, when, like, you consider we played Russia off the park in Euro 88, and we were unlucky maybe to lose to Holland, and they reached the final that year.
Yeah, it was a good team. I think when you're in the team, sometimes players and teams don't get the recognition that they deserve. And there were some really good players. I mean, top players playing in that, over 88 and 90. You know, and players playing at top clubs. I remember being sat in the dressing room in Georgia, speaking to one of the goalkeepers, a young kid, and he said he couldn't recognise any of the team, and there were only four teams represented in this picture. There was Celtic, Manchester United, Tottenham, and Liverpool. That's what the Irish team was made up of. Our team was made up of, and they were good players, good team. And if you got good players and a good team, and they're willing to work hard and you know, not be beaten, it makes for a formidable force, which it did.
He made you captain, Mick, for Italian 90, Jack Charlton. Do you think he saw a bit of himself in you?
I hope so. But I'd take that as a very big compliment, because he's a World Cup winner's medal and was a stalwart for England in 66. And, of course, a lead, he had 700 games or something. It was remarkable what he had. Maybe he did. Maybe personality-wise, might not be playing, but I've said to somebody this morning, he trusted me, which I'll forever remember him for, and I love the bones of him, Jack. You know, he entrusted me with the captaincy of Ireland, and it was the proudest moment of my life. Certainly walking down in Italy with that captain's armband on, it was great. And Jack gave me that. I wasn't the best team. I wasn't the best player in the team by any stretch of the imagination, but I guess he recognised something that maybe I got others to play and to play in front of me.
It was a magical tournament, Mick. Romania on penalties, playing Italy, the host country in Rome, meeting the Pope. It was like Conor Houlihan said, I missed Italian 90 as well. I was in Italy at the time.
Yeah, best line ever, that one. That was great. I've repeated that a few times recently because of, we've been getting calls about the anniversary of different things. Well, it was 88 and 90. And yeah, it was. We were getting newspapers sent through. You know, the first 15 pages were full of the World Cup. There was nothing going on. It was amazing. And then stories of people selling cars, selling vans, coming over and saying, sell the car. At the time, it was you couldn't believe it. And now you still hear the stories. It wouldn't surprise me if some are still paying it off. It was incredible.
What was Jack like in the dressing room, Mick?
As he was when you saw him ever on TV in front of the press. He was straightforward. I said he didn't complicate things. He told you what he wanted you to do and how he wanted you to do it. And I always remember him in 88 saying, Peter Beardsley, if he gets the ball, just run at him and make him change direction. Somebody make him change direction and don't let him pick his head up. And it was such a simple task, and yet it was brilliant, because what he meant was, of course, Peter Beardsley does allow to get turned, starts running with the ball, pick his head up, he's hard to stop, and he will pick a pass. And I remember in that game, as soon as the ball went to him, it might be Paul Lear, it could be me, it could be Kevin, it could be Paul, any one of us, we'll run at him and make him change direction. And he didn't play because of it. He didn't play as well. And that is how tactically aware he was. And he didn't dress it up trying to be clever. He just told you. And the thing was, if he told us what we were doing, me as captain would make sure we did it as a team. And that was my job.
And for a long time, when we look at the home record, Mick, teams did not know how to deal with it.
No, they didn't. And, of course, sadly, at the very end, teams did then find out how to deal with it because football had evolved. It had come over about 10 years. Well, it was 10 years when Jack was starting to... when he came to his end, it was against Holland. And teams knew that what we'd do, and they started to plan for that, and they could deal with it better. But for 88, 90, 94... You know, wonderful, wonderful memories. And like you said, teams couldn't deal with us.
Jack was a character, Mick. He liked a pint of Guinness. He liked to fish. I think the nation here, we completely took him to our hearts. Obviously, you're reflecting that sentiment today. He was a great man.
He was a wonderful man, yeah. Very open, very honest. When we saw, a real family man, his son always would be there, John. And Pat, his wife, used to travel with him. We all got to know them as a family. He was a real lovely fella. And he had it with all the fans as well. I mean, some of the stories. I mean, playing in Northern Ireland, they're all giving abuse behind the dugout, and he leaned into the crowd and literally said, "Give us a cig," and lit it up. I mean, how he could just light the place up when he walked into it. You know, he was such a big personality. And I think whoever you spoke to today, the ones that played in that squad and played regularly in that squad would say the same as me, that they all love the bones of him. It was brilliant.
Yeah, I think his legacy, Mick, could be the art of the possible, that I think the country changed under the way the team played under his management, and it just gave us some wonderful days that we could compete on the world stage, be in the top eight in the world. What will his legacy be for you, Mick, is to conclude what is a very sad conversation?
Well, I think it's what you just said, and then the 16-year-old kid is what he was at the time, how it put a smile on the face of the country, and I think it inspired the country to go on and do things. I mean, at the time, it wasn't a great time in terms of financially. The houses being built, no, they weren't. I just think it had an economic effect. I mean, it probably had a devastating economic effect when everybody spent up going to Germany and Italy. But it had almost like a productivity effect. Everything seemed to prosper on the back of that. And listen, it's not always Big Jack did that. We were just a cog in that part of the machine, and Jack, he turned it around. I think how he spoke to people, and he was so positive about it. And listen, I think everybody will be sad in Ireland today. I think everybody would back my view that we all loved him.
Mick, sentiments which we completely concur with, and we really appreciate your time, Mick, to join us on Off the Ball Saturday on News Talk to remember Jack Charlton, who's passed away at the age of 85.
John, it's a pleasure. It's not a pleasure to be speaking about his death, but it's a pleasure to be able to remember what he did for me, for the country, and for a lot of other people. And if I can just offer my condolences to his wife, Pat, and all his family.
Mick, you're a great man. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
He's there speaking to us on Off the Ball Saturday here on News Talk. I really appreciate the time that Mick and Kevin Moran and Jason McAteer and John Giles have given us today to remember Jack Charlton, who was very sadly passed away at the age of 85. Just some tweets and texts here. We want to get the listeners' memories and feelings and thoughts about Jack. Seamus Bannon on Twitter, a story of Jack and myself. The story goes, Jack and a number of other stars played in a golf tournament in Sligo in memory of legend Sean Fallon. Alex Ferguson was there, as was Neil Lennon and Paddy Bonner. I was a young member and a caddy in the summer months. So the young caddies' names were put into a hat to see who they would caddy for. Alex was the first name and my friend got him. Jack was the second name, I got him. I'm a Man United fan. I tried to swap with my friend, but he wasn't having it, as though he'd get a bigger tip for Alex. Anyway, Roy Keane had just been sent home from the World Cup, and me being a brash teenager, asked Jack what he thought, and he said he dragged Roy by the ears onto the plane. We got a good laugh, and later on, the first tee, I asked him what he thought if he'd win today's golf competition, and he said with a cheeky grin, he said, "I'd never won anything in my life," to which I responded with a big laugh, "Didn't you win the World Cup?" He just gave me another cheeky smile. The preceding 4 hours were great. Talked about his love for fishing. He did not like that I played rugby, though, although we had a great laugh about that. Such a pleasant time with him on 53106. Jack brought so much happiness to the country, whether you're into sport or not. I was in a plane from Tunisia to Palermo when we beat Romania on penalties in 1990. Pre-mobile phones, I was walking through passport control in Palermo, and when the security guy saw my passport, he said, "Congratulations." I said, "Uno zero." And he said in Italian, "No, 5-4 on penalties." I ran out, found a payphone, rang Mount Medic, asked my dad who scored the winning penalty. And when he said David O'Leary, I said, "It's a bad line. I thought he said Dave O'Leary." That's a true story from Mick in Portlaoise. John, I was at the home matches and also the quarterfinal in Rome. In terms of Irish people's confidence as a nation, another point was brought out, the incredible behaviour of Irish people, drinking all day but no thuggery, such a big part of enhancing our image abroad. Jack recognised that too. He was said he was ashamed of the English fans that tore up Lansdowne Road in 1995, from Stephen in Malahide. Thomas Niblock just put on the earphones on the walk listening for the programme. Brilliant memories of Jack, thank you. Genuinely, as a child, USA 94 was without doubt the best summer of my life. Much of that down to the Irish football team and Jack, legend of a man, on and off the pitch, a leader. 53106 to share your memories at Off the Ball on Twitter. Nathan Murphy, our head of content here at OTB Sports, joins us. Nathan, how are you?
I'm okay, John, I'm okay. I'm a bit like everybody else, I think, who's tuned in today. And on the one hand, very sad that this news that came through this morning about Jack Charlton. But on the other hand, a lot of smiles when you're listening to the stories and thinking of the memories that he provided in my youth and in so many people's younger days. And yeah, what a legacy he leaves.
I remember, Nathan, you telling me, I remember the Hungary game, I think you were about 7 or 8 years of age. McGrath scored. I remember that goal McGrath scored and the whole of Lansdowne Road going. We were just on this roller coaster of emotion. I know myself, I'm just a few years older, crying in the sheepskin rug when David O'Leary scored that winning penalty in 1990, bawling my eyes out. It's just completely wired into the DNA of your childhood. Jack Charlton brought this country to a place that was just, we'd never seen before. Television, people going to Italy, selling the cars, getting the credit union loans. This was what it was all about.
Yeah, and our generation grew up with a different sense of what Irish football could be to every previous generation. We expected, and we still do, all the conversations that we have around Irish football that dominate night after night around style of football and what we should be doing. And it all stems back to that side. It gave the nation an interest in the game. I don't think that was ever at the level it was before that. And it's all down to Jack Charlton. I don't think there's any question Jack Charlton is the most influential sporting figure ever in this country. He changed this nation, certainly in a sporting sense, and I'm sure there'll be historians over the coming days who'll be writing and talking about this in terms of the nation as a whole and in terms of Celtic Tigers and everything that went with it. And he did. We grew up in a brilliant period for Irish football, of packed houses at Lansdowne Road, of everybody can think of where they were, Stuttgart, in Genoa, running outside when the penalty was scored and wanting to be David O'Leary, and your best mate was going to be Paddy Bonner, through to Ray Houghton again. And all of that came from Jack Charlton and changed the attitude, I think, of Irish players and of Irish people of what we could be. I think at the time, because there have been so many disappointments and Irish football was such a mess in many ways, from the committee selecting the team, not getting the best out of our most talented players, there was always a sense of, you know, we're a step below everything else. Whereas Jack Charlton maybe didn't have that. He wasn't bogged down by the history of Irish football and came in and looked at the players and thought, why not? Why not? And went and did it and achieved. And listen, you can get, as John Giles said, you can get into the style of football and players who maybe weren't treated the way they should have been. But ultimately, bringing a nation of Ireland's size to a World Cup quarterfinal is an achievement that, well, let's be honest, we'll probably never see again.
And also the accidental manager shouldn't have got the job. There was a change in the vote. Bob Paisley should have got the job. And then Jack comes in. It was funny.
Yeah, and like Bob Paisley at the time is up there among the greatest managers of all time. And there's a bit of a sliding doors moment for Irish football. What would Bob Paisley have done? In a footballing sense, would it have been a more creative style? But we'll never know. And we got Jack Charlton, who bought Ireland into his heart, and Ireland bought Jack Charlton into their hearts. And it's interesting looking at the reaction to that. I would say there's not a person in this country over the age of 30 who hadn't some sort of an encounter with Jack Charlton. Everybody seems to have a photo, ran into him in some part of the country. I remember growing up in Mayo, there was obviously a strong connection. It was always felt in Mayo with Jack Charlton because he spent so much time in Ballina and being brought to Ballina for the Salmon Weir Festival. And Jack Charlton would be there launching it, and there'd be thousands upon thousands of people in the early 90s. And then the next day, I might go back again because Jack might have been fishing in the River Moy. And this insane sight of Jack in the middle of the river by himself, calmly fishing away like he would do on any other day, and every side of the River Moy packed to the rafters with people, hundreds, probably thousands of people just standing there. Granted, it was the early 90s and there wasn't much else to do, just standing there staring at Jack Charlton fishing for hours and hours. And while he didn't acknowledge it, you got the sense from Jack's personality inside he was loving it.
Yeah, and we've heard that, Nathan, from Kevin Moore and Jason McAteer, Mick McCarthy on the show in the last hour and a half. To me, this guy was a really good man manager, a really good psychologist, a really good, he could be gruff, he could be just give you a bollocking, and then the next moment, as Jason said, he put your arm around you. He was just a human being that liked to have fun, knew when to, the light and shade was really good with Jack, and he was able to just get the players to believe in themselves. In a country that was on its knees, economically on its knees, people emigrating from Ireland in the 80s. Now, you can't say that this contributed to an economic recovery, but it certainly didn't harm it. And for people who'd never, maybe possibly even left Ireland, to be going to Germany, to be going in the van, the camper van across Europe to Germany, to Euro 88, to be going to Italia 90, and then even the party back home, this gave us, I think, a feeling that, you know what, we're not going to take it anymore as a country. And that was epitomised in the way the team played. Wasn't pretty, but it was effective.
Yeah, it wasn't pretty, but it was his way of playing the game. And at times, people might have described it as like long ball, caveman football. But he had thought about this. He came from a Leeds United side who thought about football, who spoke about football, who rowed about football, as John Giles said earlier. They would row and row and row, and ultimately Jack would be right, in Jack's head. So it wasn't as if he had and had played in a team that could play football at Leeds, and obviously were able to get stuck in as well. But he thought there was a different way of playing the game. So regardless of the fact that we can look back at that group in 88 and the talent that was there, and Ronnie Whelan and David O'Leary and Liam Brady and what could have happened, he was so set in his way of how he wanted the team to play and had thought about it. And we spent a lot of time over the last 3-4 months delving into nostalgia, and we've covered a lot of those games from 88, 90, 94 and Classic Game Club, and watched back the Ireland-Italy game from Giant Stadium. And the quality of Ireland's football that day, it's not what I imagine a Jack Charlton team to be. You've John Sheridan and Andy Townsend and Roy Keane in midfield, and they're getting the ball down and they're passing it around. And this is an Italian side that gets all the way to the World Cup final, and Paul McGrath stroking around in defence. This is a side that could play and were allowed to play. All right, there were earlier examples, obviously, in Italia 90, where you watch back that England match and it is absolute drudgery, and it's just kick out after kick out from Paddy Bonner. But at the time, it got the job done. But there was development, I think, of the style of play, particularly when you look at that performance. You mentioned the Russia one in 88. I think the standout moments in terms of performance-wise were either Russia or the game against Italy, where Ireland actually played some serious football, getting it down, showing their talent, showing their technique. But that's not, it's, you know, the footballing memory is probably more of the moments than the performances.
Yeah, the feeling I was always about had, Nathan, that there's always going to be another moment. There's always going to be something. We'll just get out of this in some way, like the England game in 90 or the Holland game in 90, the Romania game. We'll squeeze through. There was a belief there. Like Jack went to Mexico in 86, found a kind of a solution to this way that everybody else was playing in a certain way. He wanted to play in a different way. Came back from Mexico, was from the Charles Hughes school of football philosophy. And for 7 years, we didn't lose at home. Like, it was impossible for teams to come here. And that World Cup qualification campaign in 90, we steamrolled teams. Denmark in 92 won the European Championship, didn't get through the group in 94. We were bloody effective. And to me, whatever people can say whatever they want about the way he played, the results showed that we got to a World Cup quarterfinal. Who knows what would happen if we got to Euro 92. And I think the heat killed us in 94. And you got to put down a lot of that down to Jack.
Absolutely. And we will never know what would have happened if they'd gone to Italia 90 with a different style of football. It was never going to happen, though, because Jack was never for chaining. No matter what Dunphy said in studio, no matter what Giles said in studio, by and large, it was water off a duck's back. He'd have an argument about it, but he was never going to turn his back. And it's what you say, he believed. And I think that's the one thing that needs to be acknowledged. He did believe in this. It wasn't some sort of accidental, ill-prepared side that turned up in these games. He had thought about it. He had thought about the long ball football, winning second balls. We played the clip in the montage talking about putting him under pressure, and from that famous clip, put him under pressure. That is what football now is based on. What do Liverpool do? They put him under pressure. All right, when they get the ball, they do something different. But first and foremost, they don't let the other side rest. Pep Guardiola's Barcelona didn't let the other side rest. Ireland were never tiki-taka. But that was the starting point of actually win the ball back, high up the pitch, get your second balls and take advantage. And it was an era of the back pass as well, which Ireland utilised better and more often than the vast majority of teams. There's not many pretty games of football from that sort of late 80s, early 90s period. So Ireland weren't alone in that. We were probably the experts in terms of how to make the most out of a long ball. And it did get results, and it got the greatest results by and large in our history. So to get to three major finals in the space of 6 years, like nowadays, and I know the qualification structure has changed, and that, like, that's where we really need to ram that home. It was a whole lot more difficult to get to major championships at that stage. You know, eight teams in Euro 88, and Ireland were very much the equal of every other side at that tournament, in a tournament that's seen as one of the great European championships.
Yeah, and I'm just going through some of the text here, Nathan. They always say that Ireland changed economically after the adventures of Ireland under Jack Charlton. Yes, we were all broke after Euro 88, Italy 90 and USA 94. May he rest in peace. That is from Andrew in Cork. I remember working stacking shelves in Quinsworth in 1990 while the Romania game was on. Match was on the tannoy. No shoppers whatsoever. Just about 10 staff and the manager. When O'Leary took the winning penalty, we went nuts around the shop. Manager knew there'd be no more worthwhile work out of us. Locked up the shop and off to the pub. That is from Jack. Another text in here in 53106. Met Jack in Ballyshannon in 1992. There were hundreds of school kids going mad to shake his hand. Any normal person would run into the nearest pub and wait for his kids to go back to the school, but not Jack. He shook every kid's hand that day, and he did so with a smile. Such a legend. Martin Burke as well was at my brother-in-law's wedding during USA 94 when Ray Houghton scored against Italy. Arhelau House Hotel laid out the chairs like a cinema with a big screen. Unforgettable day, unforgettable decade for Irish football. Rest in peace, Jack. And I think it also brings home to me, Nathan, that it's a global religion, football. It's played around the world. 200 nations. Rugby isn't, with a no disrespect to it. GA obviously is an indigenous sport in this country. When we perform at major tournaments, this is the show. And Jack made this the show forever, as far as I'm concerned, because it still is the show.
Yeah, and it shows in the disappointment when we don't make the show as well, because we know what it can be like, even in 2002 and all the sideshow that happened there, those moments, and Robbie Keane's late goal and getting the penalty shootout. These are the moments, the first moments when you think of Irish sport. And he brought that. He brought that. He did bring Irish football and Irish sport in general to a whole other level. There was bits and pieces before that. There was the odd Olympic medal here and there. But suddenly it felt like this was a nation that suddenly had a bit of an identity, a sporting identity, and an identity outside of sport. Because Irish people obviously feel that we have a certain personality and we enjoy the crack. And I often wonder, was that in the 70s and 80s very much an internal thing that we enjoyed ourselves? Whereas this allowed it to bring it to the world. And I'm sure people will say there's a downside to that as well. But actually, Irish supporters and people sitting at home do criticise. But when you go to major tournaments and Irish supporters there, the love that is there for Irish supporters from other countries is something to behold. It's not there. It's not there for other fan bases. And again, that was built into that period, built up in Euro 88. And the sense from the supporters of, how are we doing this? How have we got to a major tournament? We are a poor little backwater that suddenly is there with the big giants. And we've taken all our money from the credit union. We've somehow managed to get to Stuttgart. We've done the jocks are on it. And we are going to have a bloody good time. And that attitude has remained. Again, people are critical that there is a, we're there for a good time, maybe not for success. But Jack Charlton showed you can pretty much have both. You can have both. And that team, the stories will come out again and again and again. And we've heard so many of them before from those players, because like, they enjoyed themselves. They loved that period. And ringing around former players this morning, asking will they come on, like, an awful lot of them were just too upset still, because Jack means that much to them. It's not a case of he was just another manager, a manager who brought them success. There was a bond there between that group of players that they will never lose. And that's something he got from that lead side as well, because as you mentioned, unfortunately, we've had Norman Hunter pass away in the last couple of months. We've had Trevor Cherry. And as John Giles said that night when Norman Hunter passed away, they were a band of brothers as well. There was a bond there in that group that they'll never lose. And this team and that group of 88, 90, 94 is the exact same. In 30 years, they will still be getting together. They'll still be sharing the stories. And everyone will still want to hear them. And all of that is thanks to Jack Charlton.
Yeah, we're a republic. We're not a monarchy. We don't have the royal family. We don't have the tourism of that. We don't really have that many heroes. We're sometimes seen as a bit of a great nation as we are. Sometimes we're seen as a bit of a nation of begrudgers. Like, how many heroes do we legitimately have? Michael D. Higgins is very popular as a president. But Jack Charlton, to me, I think, I know there's criticism of the football, but ultimately he will be seen as one of the nation's great heroes. Like great heroes going back, and possibly our greatest sporting hero. And that's hopefully the legacy that for people that unfortunately, as we say, are maybe under 30 years of age, who don't know what this was like. Hopefully, even us talking about Jack today will just give people a sense, maybe a bit more curious about the man, curious about what we were doing back then, and inspire us, hopefully, under Stephen Kenny or in other sports to achieve on the world stage.
Yeah, look, what Stephen Kenny's looking to do is probably going to be a slightly different thing to what Jack Charlton did. But ultimately, the aim is the same. It's to bring the nation together behind one team, which is the national soccer team, which, as you say, is unlike anything else when things are going well. And yeah, there will be any amount of nostalgia. And listen, I'm sure, like everybody, there were flaws to Jack Charlton, but there was a brilliant side to him as well. And there'll be criticisms of particularly the style of football, I'm sure, of the way certain individuals were treated. But he was a man who had and was steadfast in what he wanted to do and went and did it and achieved and did it in an unbelievably likable manner, as you say. Like, everybody has met him. Everybody has a photo with him when they were a kid. And that meant he stopped and got that photo taken. He didn't walk off. He put up with it. He put up with the thousands upon thousands, I'm sure, of people who'd had one or two too many, went to various openings here, there and everywhere, but seemed to absolutely love it, love the attention that it gave him. And is, you know, very charismatic, very sociable character. And for Ireland, a brilliant football manager and a brilliant football man when you look at what he achieved with England, with Leeds United, and then to take that on and say change the way football is looked at in this country forever. So I think we'll all be indebted to him for that.
Well, Nathan, thanks for joining us today. I think maybe later on I might have a socially distant pint of the black stuff and raise it to Jack Charlton. Thanks for sharing your memories today on Off the Ball Saturday.
Thanks, John.
Nathan Murphy there, 53106 for your text messages. I was best man for best mate the day we beat Romania to get to the last eight of the World Cup. The penalty shootout added to the excitement and made for an unforgettable time. My first host of the day was to Packy and to Big Jack. Kevin Sheedy, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, John.
Kevin, a tough day, very sad day, as I've expressed to the other football guests. And you were part of the whole show. You scored that penalty against Romania in 1990. And Jack, you must have very fond memories on a very sad day following his passing.
It is indeed a very sad day, but every time someone mentions Jack Charlton's name, it always brings a smile to my face. So many fantastic memories. Everybody's got different stories about him. But I think listening to different people over today, and the big thing that I've thought about is I played for Ireland before Jack was manager, and we had a lot of very, very good players, top players, but we didn't have the leadership to get the best out of those players. And I think when you look back at what Jack Charlton's reign was, I think he came out what he did. He came out as an actual leader. People criticise maybe the style of football, but if you look at the players that we had in the side, all the players were playing for the top teams, playing in top competitions, European, domestic. And sort of towards 88-90, we were sort of coming to the pinnacle of our careers. So the style of football, okay, but it was long balls with quality. You had Steve Staunton, Dennis Irwin playing long balls from full-back positions with the quality that they've got. We had players who all bought into Jack's press and put him under pressure, which teams weren't used to. And, we got great success out of it.
Kevin, this seems to me was about character and backbone inspired by Jack.
Absolutely. I mean, Jack made a couple of big decisions early on in his international career, and he got the players in that he wanted. He built the team that he wanted, and we didn't get results straight away. But after a certain period, we started to get results, and results breed confidence. And then all of a sudden, you've got top players buying into what Jack wanted, putting pressure on the opposition, winning the ball back in the opposition's half. And all these players had quality. We could score goals from different positions. We could create opportunities. So, you know, Jack was very shrewd and a very clever manager.
What's your first memories of encountering Jack, Kevin?
Just his... in training, we always used to have like a yellow jersey, and I was okay in training, but he was always trying to get me to get the yellow jersey. You know, you'd vote for who you thought was the worst performer in the five-a-sides, and Jack kept on and on about giving it to me, and one day I eventually got it, so that brought a big smile to his face. But generally, the whole camp was, relaxed. He loved the camaraderie of the players. He loved being in the middle of them. He allowed the players to socialise, I heard someone mentioning before, at the right times. But certainly, everyone, loved Jack, and he was straight. You know, if he needed to tell you something, he didn't beat about the bush. He told it to you straight. And if you got on with it and did what he wanted, that was fine. I had a great relationship with Jack. He liked me as a player. He allowed me to perform like I could. He got the best out of me. And I'll always be forever thankful. He gave me some of my best footballing moments ever.
You were like a league winner with Everton. You were a European Cup winner, Scope winner, Kevin, in the 1980s. You were top of the game. Did Jack talk to you much about what you were doing at the club at the time, or was it very much a case of you come in with Ireland, do you do your job and you leave?
I think it was a bit of both. I mean, he obviously knew what was going on in the domestic. I mean, it was us against Liverpool, for the league, for cups. We were doing well in Europe. So he knew what was going on. But generally, when you arrive for the Sunday night, you just get together with the lads, have a chat, and then you'd be preparing for the midweek game. So I think Jack then was very much focused on what we were going to do for Ireland, getting the players focused on the game, knowing the opposition, and going out and performing. So I was very fortunate, as you said, I was coming over from Everton. We had a great camaraderie, great set of lads on and off the pitch, and it was exactly the same, with Ireland. And I'm just so grateful we had a reunion last year at the K Club that I was able to attend. Most of the lads were there. We had a great time. Obviously, Jack was there. So that's the last time I saw him. So, it was a great get-together with all the lads, and I'm sure Jack will have enjoyed it as well.
Any memorable moments that stand out? Good stories, Kevin?
He was just a character. John, he just... It's difficult, everyone's got a story about him. But I think I've just got to go to his man management skills. Me personally, we never had many conversations, but a couple of times he'd call me into his room and he'd have a chat about what he'd expect from me, what he wanted me to do, the game today, what he expected. And he made the game real easy. He painted the picture for you. I want you to do this. I don't want you to do that. And he knew exactly what you wanted. And I think the squad as a whole knew exactly what was expected of them. And, it was so I'm so privileged to have been part of that great era.
Russia in 1988 was some game, Kevin. I remember you were beginning to get into the first team around then, Euro 88, and you would eventually be in the first team in 1990. Does that stand out as a memorable day under Jack?
It was. When you look back at that competition, we came so close. Obviously beating England and then Russia. It wasn't the broken up teams like it is now. It was the whole of Russia. They had a great side. We drew 1-0. We should have beaten them. And then Holland, we got beat 6 minutes from time. And then Holland and Russia got in the final. So we came very close. But I think that generator gave us the confidence. I remember after the last game, we were back at the hotel, and I'd sort of been subbed for the first game against England, played against Russia. Paul McGrath was injured, and then Paul was fit for the next game against Holland, and I was sub again and came on at half time. And I was disappointed not to have played all the minutes. But after the game, we were having a meal, and Jack pulled me to one side and said, I know I should have played you more. He said, but you'll be a definite starter for the World Cup campaign. And as a player, that's all you can ask for. You know the manager's got confidence in you. And, then he kept his word. I played in all the games. So, nothing but great memories with Jack.
And you scored the first goal of the World Cup in 1990 against England. Did he say anything to you afterwards?
He just said, well done, son. Not too many words from Jack. He's just so relieved. As we all were to get the point. One of my best ever moments, Ireland's first ever goal at the World Cup. So really proud of that achievement. But it was more important when you look back that enables us to qualify out of the group and the rest of the fantastic memories that we had.
And the belief, once again, that you had by that stage, you came through the qualification campaign very well. By the time you got to the penalties, were you confident, Kevin, that you were going to do Romania in the penalty shootout? You scored a cracking penalty.
It was. Well, I was an experienced penalty taker. If we'd had one in normal play, it was either John Aldridge or myself. John went off injured, so if we'd had a penalty, I'd have taken it. And when the final whistle went after extra time, I just said to Jack, I'll take the first one. I had great belief that I could score, and I thought, well, if I save my penalty till the end and some of the lads don't score, then it's a wasted penalty. So I had extreme confidence that I was going to score. It's a long wait from the final whistle to actually when I took the penalty, which was about 20 minutes. So you just got to go into a zone and just think what you're going to do. I'd rehearsed what I was going to do, hit it as hard as I could, down the middle, but high, knowing the goalkeeper's got to dive. So fortunately, held my nerve, and obviously the lads, Ray Howden, Andy Townsend, Cass, and then the brilliant penalty from Dave O'Leary, which was, you know, it was, again, another fantastic memory.
Could you believe almost what was happening to you that night after the game in Genoa, and then you're on the road to play the host in a quarterfinal of a World Cup, and Jack has imbued you with all this confidence?
Indeed, and you know, we felt we could have beaten anybody. The confidence was that sky high. Jack didn't complicate it then. He just, you know, he was more or less picking the same team. Everyone knew what they were, you know, capable of doing. And we came really close against Italy. You know, Jack said after the game, you'll never know how close you've come to winning the World Cup. And when you look at Italy against Argentina in the semi-final, they were still a good team, Argentina, but they're an ageing team with Maradona. And then the final, West Germany, Argentina, that wasn't, you know. So you look back, and Jack's words were quite right. You know, so, you know, really pleased with how we did, but he just thought if we could, we just couldn't get that goal against Italy.
I think you changed the lives of so many people over a certain age here, Kevin, in Ireland. I'm sure he changed your life, and he leaves a great legacy, I think. It's a very sad day. We're paying tribute to him. We're very sad that he's passed, Jack Charlton, but he's somebody that you'll always hold in huge regard and a warmth.
Absolutely, John, in the highest regard. As I said at the start, you know, every time someone mentions his name, he puts a smile on my face. You know, he was just, he was funny without knowing he was being funny. You know, the lads, the jokers, Cascarino, Andy Townsend, Aldo, you know, if they were playing games, and, you know, he'd love to be in the middle of it, you know, joining in and that. So, no, we knew he was the manager. He kept his distance when he needed to. He joined in when he needed to. And he was like, if anybody says about Ireland, Euros 88, 90 World Cup, 94 World Cup, the first name people mention would be Jack Charlton.
Kevin Sheedy, you're such a gentleman to join us on Off the Ball Saturday here on News Talk. Thanks so much.
Cheers, John. Thank you.
Kevin Sheedy there. We'll be back after this.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. When you've done your hammer during PE with Joe, relax. The football's back. Gamble responsibly. See Dunleary.net.
Tech Talk. With Jess Kelly.
On the latest Tech Talk, the Deputy Data Protection Commissioner speaks exclusively to me about the HSE's COVID Tracker app. We'll explore how it works, what information it needs, and bust some of the myths that are out there.
Tech Talk. With Jess Kelly.
Listen and subscribe to the podcast now, or tune in this evening at 5.
On News Talk.
With more and more Irish businesses on the move again, Peugeot dealers around the country are ready to meet all your needs with an exciting range of award-winning vans. Big or small, whatever size your business is, we have the perfect van with surprisingly competitive offers to match. The Expert, the Boxer, and the new Peugeot Partner, Irish Van of the Year 2020. Arrange a test drive at your nearest Peugeot dealer or visit Peugeot.ie.
Weekly wonders at Dunn's Stores. A whole week's worth of value just for you. This week we've Walker's Crisp 6-packs, half price, and John West Tuna Fridge Packs, half price, plus Ariel Fairy and Bowl Detergent 57 packs, €10 each, and Fairy Dishwasher Tablets 55 pack, also €10. Plus, with our grocery voucher, you save an additional €10 on every €50 you spend. Weekly wonders every week at Dunn's Stores. Always better value. Terms and conditions apply. Minimum spend required.
What is your bliss? To reconnect with amazing scenery and the great outdoors? Or to remain indoors with delicious food and great conversation? to reconnect with family and friends. At FBD Hotels and Resorts, we know nothing is more important than to reconnect with your bliss. Nothing feels better or more valuable. FBD Hotels and Resorts. Reconnect.
I've never made a claim before.
Don't worry, this is the first time for you, but I deal with these kind of situations all the time.
Okay.
My name is Steph, and you can deal with me directly for any issues you have.
Thanks so much, Steph.
In the real world, it's better to speak with someone you know. So when you make a claim with Liberty Insurance, you get a dedicated claims buddy to help you get back up and running without hassle or fuss. Get our best quote in just 2 minutes at libertyinsurance.ie. Liberty Insurance, ready for the real world.
Liberty Seguros Compañía de Seguros, Araya Seguros, S.A.A., trading as Liberty Insurance, is authorised by the General Directorate of Insurance and Pension Funds in Spain and is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland for conduct of business rules.
Looking for a top-quality mattress that is 100% Irish-designed and Irish-made, with dedicated sleep experts to help find the best mattress for you? Well, this weekend, get to the Harvey Norman 4-Day Mattress Clearance, where you can get Irish-made single mattresses from just €89, 800 pocket sprung mattresses from just €299, as well as massive deals across all the biggest brands, like half-price Odeiros mattresses, discounts across the entire King Coil range, and more. Harvey Norman Mattress 4-Day Clearance, now on.
The COVID-19 crisis is not over, but thanks to the solidarity of the Irish people, we are taking the first steps on a return to normal life. But this means that it is more important than ever that we all act responsibly. The virus hasn't changed. It is highly infectious. It still poses huge risks. The simple things are still the most important things. We must wash our hands regularly, observe coughing and sneezing etiquette, maintain social distancing, avoid crowds where possible, and stay away from any place that you feel might be unsafe. Please always use your personal judgment to decide whether you're in a safe environment. Wear face coverings on public transport and in shops, and in places where it is hard to maintain social distancing. Please continue to work from home as much as possible. Walk and cycle if you can, and use public transport only if necessary. And business owners, please follow the guidance and keep your premises safe for your staff and customers. We must all continue to work together to make sure Ireland reopens safely for everyone. We have made great progress, and our challenge now is to avoid a resurgence. So please be sensible, be responsible, be safe, and look out for each other and our communities. Full details of the reopening of Ireland are available at gov.ie. Thank you. Supported by the Government of Ireland.
With the OnPost Money app, you can open a current account from the comfort of your couch, as well as earn money back into your account when you shop with any of our partners. So far, our customers have earned over 1 million euro, because when it comes to your money, you deserve more than a bank. Download the OnPost Money app or visit your local post office today. OnPost Money current account. Money back is based on spend with selected money back partners. A monthly maintenance fee applies. See onpost.com. Terms and conditions apply. OnPost is authorised by the Minister for Finance to provide payment services and is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland in the provision of such services.
The switching revolution continues at Carphone Warehouse, with deals you won't find anywhere else. Get the Huawei P30 Pro and a GT smartwatch for just €49.99 on a €40 a month plan with Vodafone, now with unlimited data, but only when you switch at Carphone Warehouse. And get the brand new Samsung S20 5G free when you switch to a Vodafone €60 a month plan with unlimited data. So get into your local Carphone Warehouse store and join the switching revolution today. T's and C's apply, offer subject to availability and 24-month contract.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power.
When you've watched more Belarusia Premier League than is healthy, proper football is back.
Gamble responsibly. See dunhuey.net.
This is Off the Ball Saturday on News Talk. John Duggan with you through to 5 o'clock. A special show paying tribute to Jack Charlton, who has very sadly passed away at the age of 85. We're going to talk a bit more about that in a moment. Just to update you, Norwich have been relegated from the Premier League, a 4-0 defeat at home to West Ham United. Mikel Antonio scoring all four goals for the Hammers, and Watford beating Newcastle by 2-1. Troy Deeney with both goals for Watford, including a late penalty. So what does it leave the situation as? West Ham 34 points, Watford 34 points, Bournemouth 28, Villa 27, and Norwich now relegated. The cement is beginning to settle on that relegation battle, and it looks like Bournemouth and Aston Villa have got a huge mountain to climb. Jack Charlton, loads of tributes coming in here on the text messages. We really appreciate everybody texting in and tweeting in at Off the Ball. on 53106 is our text number, with some great stories and individual memories and personal memories you want to share, and you want to pay your own tributes to Jack Charlton. Here's one. I'll never forget the Euros 1988. I travelled there, was a very proud Irish fan. I've got two wonderful memories, both prior to and after the match against Russia. Prior to the Russian game, the neutral German supporters were bringing their kids along to the match. Myself and my pal were stopped three times by different groups, and they asked us to get a photo with them and their kids. They wanted a photo with Irish fans. The fans stood us proud and still do. Also, that game against Russia, Ireland's best ever football-wise. No ball, long ball tactics that day. We played Russia off the pitch, and what a goal by Ronnie Whelan. Fantastic memories. Thanks to Jack. May he rest in peace. That is from Mo in Donnybrook. Great stuff, Mo. I still don't follow one team in the Premiership because Jack was the manager of my team. My long ball, my grandmother would shout, "Come on, Jack," at any player in green because Packy was the only player she knew. At the packed pub full of homemade T-shirts and smiling painted faces, a village community having shared life memories together. In 1994, I was living in Paris, and the early days of Satanta in Flannery O'Brien's gave me the Irish a hub. The Orlando Heat was shouting the referee like we weren't halfway across the world. Jack was much as family and friends who came together out to watch our team. Jack brought everybody together and we had a blast on 53106. We've got some reaction from people out and about with Ben Finnegan. We'll hear from that now.
It's very sad this morning to see that Jack has passed away. He done an awful lot for Ireland in the soccer end of it, and he was a gentleman. Just going down to the town and celebrating, and had a great time.
Oh, I'm so sorry to hear about him because he made the Irish team. I know the players, he really brought them on, and I'm not a real great fan of football, but my husband loved it and he followed Ireland, and I'll never forget him. It just took you in. It's like as if it adopted you. You know, but no, I have wonderful memories, I have to say. And thank God my husband at the time was able to follow them. He went everywhere. Like, he brought our country on. It was like a big advertisement for Ireland, really, you know. I was very, very sorry. I only heard it on the bus when I was coming into town that he had died. I couldn't believe it now, you know.
Great memories of Jack Charlton. I met him one day at a function in the RDS. He offered me tickets for the match that night, and unfortunately I couldn't even take them. But I have a very good photograph of the two of us together, and my son, who's a great soccer fan, we're trying to find it for him at the moment. I'm sorry now I didn't take up the offer to two tickets and found a way of getting out of my prior commitment.
Yeah, definitely my dad would probably have been much closer to home for him. Just that he was a legendary Irish manager actually makes me think of the Christy Moore song, Joxer.
Ah, oh, that's sad. I know it's a legend gone, isn't it, really? Yeah, that's sad. And I'm sure he thoroughly enjoyed his term with the Irish team at that time in particular when he was managing the Irish team. But that was the best ever time that we had in Irish football. It was just fantastic. I mean, it was such a fantastic atmosphere, and everything else just went by the wayside, and it was all focused on the team and our progress through the tournament at the time. And everybody was in great form, and all the emotions that it brought out in people as well, all different emotions, and people who were probably never interested in football latched on and became involved and created a much better atmosphere. It was fantastic, and I'm sorry to hear he's dead now.
Jack Charlton, he was one of the best for Ireland. I mean, he was incredible, the guy. It's sad to see, it's a sad loss. But my dub at heart, I've been here for about 22 years, so I'm at home here.
People giving their memories about Jack Charlton, has very sadly passed away at the age of 85. We're on the air until 5 here on News Talk, Off the Ball Saturday, and John Duggan with you through. We're going to have Mark Lawrenson, Ray Houghton coming up on the show, Daniel McDonald, Vincent Hogan, all to give their memories of Jack. Here's some text, 53106. I was telling my kids this morning about Jack and the boys in green, and all those incredible days came flooding back. When David O'Leary scored the penalty, my 12-year-old self ran up to my room crying. I looked out my window and the whole street was going out bananas outside. Don't think we'll see the likes of it again. Thanks for all the beautiful memories, Jack. Rest in peace. That is from Stephen, Jessica and George Doyle. Also, I was privileged to be present at Jack's finest moments with Ireland, Stuttgart 88, Genoa and Rome 1990, USA Giants Stadium 1994, unforgettable memories. My favourite Jack moment, Stuttgart, where it all began, the pre-match warm-up. Ireland were in front of our fans behind the Ray Houghton goal. Jack and Morris setters walking around letting the players get on with it. We started cheering Jack's name. They waved back, stood still in their shirt sleeves for about 2 minutes and just smiled to each other, marvelling at the sight in front of them. No words were needed. I just believe and hope they took such satisfaction in what they had achieved special. That is from Carl in Galway. 53106, Off the Ball Saturday, back after this.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. When you've seen West Ham beat Preston in the 1963 FA Cup final for the sixth time, live football is back. Gamble responsibly. CWE.net.
Sign up for News Talk Extra,
our email newsletter straight to your inbox.
Newstalk.com/extra.
While other luxury car manufacturers are transitioning to the future of motoring, Lexus is already there. Ceasing production of diesel cars 7 years ago and building an unrivaled expertise in hybrid innovation. Today, the Lexus range is the first choice for self-charging luxury hybrids. So if you feel it's time to move on from diesel, put your mind at rest and let your heart race. Welcome to Luxury Hybrid. Lexus. Experience amazing.
Afternoons are easy with InsureMyVan.ie, Ireland's low-cost van insurance specialists. Get your business back on the road with InsureMyVan's best price guarantee. For super savings, visit InsureMyVan.ie. City Financial Marketing Group Limited, training as InsureMyVan.ie, is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
Missing this?
This is the dream. Shohi on Bringlord. Whether you're from Cushendall in Antrim or Mount Sine in Waterford, this is what it's all about.
Hey, get this, the all-new OTB Sports app. Off the Ball, Ireland's premier sports channel, now has a new home, featuring the biggest names in Irish and world sports. Podcasts, interviews, news, commentary, analysis, plus almost 20 years of sporting archives. All free, ready when you are, at home or on the go. The new OTB Sports app. Download it now from the App Store and Google Play.
From the apartment in the city to the cottage in the country, at Energia, we're the power behind a quarter of a million customers across Ireland. And right now, there's never been a better time to join us and save on your electricity and gas with our cheapest dual fuel bundle. Wherever you're living, know you always get the biggest savings by coming direct to us. Go direct to energia.ie and switch today. Energia, the power behind your savings. EAB €1,364 based on average annual usage, 12-month contract, discounted unit rate, standing charge, PSO levy and carbon tax, T's and C's and early termination fee apply. Valid from June 2020 and subject to change. Verification and T's and C's at energia.ie/EAB.
On Thursday, July 16th from 5 to 7pm, National College of Ireland is hosting a virtual open evening where our lecturers and admissions team will be live online to answer questions about our wide range of full and part-time courses. To register, call 1850 221 721 or visit ncirl.ie.
With the OnPost Money app, you can open a current account from the comfort of your couch, as well as earn money back into your account when you shop with any of our partners. So far, our customers have earned over €1 million, because when it comes to your money, you deserve more than a bank. Download the OnPost Money app or visit your local post office today. OnPost Money current account. Money back is based on spend with selected money back partners. A monthly maintenance fee applies. See onpost.com. Terms and conditions apply. OnPost is authorised by the Minister for Finance to provide payment services and is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland in the provision of such services.
Local community pharmacies across Ireland have remained open throughout the COVID-19 crisis, putting new measures in place to keep everyone safe and healthy. We would like to thank all our customers for your kindness, cooperation and understanding of the changes we have had to make. What hasn't changed is the quality of care we provide, supplying the medicines you need and the advice you trust. Your local community pharmacy, always here for you. Brought to you by the Irish Pharmacy Union.
The country is on the way to reopening, but the world and our roads have changed since we were last out here. There are now more of us cycling and more of us walking, and there are more reasons to look out for each other. Drivers, please slow down and take care when passing pedestrians and cyclists. Pedestrians, always walk on the footpath. If there isn't one, on the right-hand side of the road facing oncoming traffic. We're on the road back. Make it a safer one. A message from the Road Safety Authority and An Garda Síochána.
This summer at Centra, we have everything you need. Like Centra Irish Sirloin Steak 500 gram, only €5. Coca-Cola 1.5 litre, only €2. And our mega deal until Sunday, Griffon Prosecco Frizzante or Rosé, 2 for €15. Centra, live every day. Enjoy call sensibly.
One of the beauties of staying in the Gaumont Hotel and Spa in Galway is you won't know which way to look. Galway City Centre.
3 minutes one way.
Famous Loch Atolia.
Just below the Gaumont Hotel's large outdoor terrace.
Beautiful Connemara or Burren Country.
Over there.
Galway Bay.
All around.
Or indulge yourself in their luxury pool and spa.
Just a few seconds from your beautiful room. The Gaumont Hotel and Spa.
A perfect place, perfectly placed.
For great special offers, see the Gaumont.
On 106 to 108 FM. On Newstalk.com.
On smart speaker.
And on the Newstalk app. This is Newstalk.
It's 3 o'clock. Good afternoon. I'm Stephen Burke. The President and the Taoiseach are leading the tributes to Jack Charlton, who's died at the age of 85. He had lymphoma and dementia and passed away last night at his home in England with his family by his side. Former Republic of Ireland striker John Aldridge says the players would have done anything for Jack.
We'd literally go through a brick wall. If anybody told us to do it, we'd just do it for him. And people forget, you know, he got us into the world rankings. I think it was fifth or sixth. You know, wow, how good was that? The togetherness in that camp was unbelievable. I adored the man.
A senior police officer from England has been picked to supervise the PSNI's investigation into the Bobby Storey funeral in West Belfast last month. The PSNI is investigating possible breaches of pandemic health protection regulations after the Sinn Féin leadership marched past large numbers of mourners. Mark Webster, Deputy Chief Constable of Cumbria Constabulary, has been named to oversee and direct the investigation into the funeral and its background. The North's Police Ombudsman is also considering a complaint about police actions leading up to the funeral. The government's summer provision programme has been extended to include children with complex needs entering primary school. It has regarded as even more important this year because of the closure of schools since the 12th of March because of the pandemic. Minister of State for Special Education, Josepha Madigan, says it will be a big help to children who've been missing school.
It has been difficult for children not to be in school at all. For children with complex needs and special needs, we want them to be able to enter school, to get used to the school environment, and the summer provision gives them a platform in order to be able to do that.
The decision to reopen the perimeter gates of Dublin's Phoenix Park to car traffic has been met with major criticism. The change was ordered despite the OPW stating just last week that park roads were being kept free for people to socially distance while walking or cycling. Green Party MEP Kieran Cuff says the OPW should reconsider.
There always has to be a balance between the needs of traffic and the needs of people and families. But I think in this instance, the OPW have blinked and they've gone too far in the opposite direction.
It's 2 minutes past three.
News Talk weather.
Thanks to the AA. Download the new AA app to request a roadside rescue and track the patrol right to your car.
Mainly dry with a mix of cloud and sun, the best of that in the south of the country. Top temperatures of 15 to 20 degrees. And now you're up to date on News Talk.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power.
It's not quite a TikTok lip sync of Donald Trump, but it's a close second.
Gamble responsibly. See dunlewy.net.
You are welcome back to Off the Ball Saturday on News Talk. John Duggan with you 3 to 5 o'clock. We're paying tribute to Jack Charlton, who has very sadly passed away at the age of 85. We're on the air until 5 o'clock. Lots more guests to come and text messages and tweets. 53106 for your texts here on News Talk and at Off the Ball on Twitter. My dad was involved with a local soccer club in Tipperary for many years, and my parents met Jack at the All-Star Soccer Awards in the late 80s and early 1990s. My mum had her photo taken with Jack, and it says, "Pride of place. At home, they said he was a true gentleman. Rest in peace, Jack." That is from Tracy. "My most wonderful memory of Italia 90 was the first time I made a pizza, drank Italian wine, had my sister and all my sons to the house wearing our green jerseys. We will never forget. Rest in peace, Jack." That is from Maura in Bray. Stuttgart, after a great win over England, got about 1 hour's sleep before heading to the airport. Got a taxi, arrived, got out of the taxi. It was the railway station. Luckily enough, we managed to find another taxi. We made it to the flight just in time. That is from John. And also a statement in here from Paul McGrath. And we're going to read that out now. "Today, I'm truly heartbroken at Jack's passing. It was difficult for me to articulate what Jack meant to me both on and off the football field. Throughout his 10 years as manager of our international team, Jack backed me as a footballer and as a person. He became a father figure to me. He gave me his full support when I needed it most, and for which I'm forever grateful. He has been a hugely important person in my life. The Irish people warmed him because of his big character, and he gave us the belief in ourselves to compete in the big tournaments. I'm very honoured to have been a part of Jack's journey. Today is a sad day for the Irish football community, and we all owe him a huge gratitude for the joy and memories he's given us. He's a man I genuinely loved. My thoughts today are with Pat and the Charlton family. Thank you, Jack. Sleep well, Paul. Paul McGrath there with a lovely tribute to Jack Charlton. We've got Daniel McDonnell on the line, the football correspondent of the Irish Independent. Daniel, good afternoon.
Afternoon, John.
Yeah, sad day, Daniel. Jack wasn't well, but he was a huge figure in Irish sport and in the Irish nation.
Ah, yeah, John. It's a I suppose national grief today, and it's not overstating it. I don't think, you know, it's obviously a powerful legacy that someone leaves when, you know, their name is synonymous not just with their, you know, them, the personality, you know, that person, but what they represent. Like what they represent in the lives of like so many Irish people of like so many different generations. And even the, you know, I'm feeling myself, you know, consider myself very fortunate that I do remember the glory years, that I was just about old enough to, you know, sort of turning 5, 6 in Euro 88 and thinking this was the norm. But like, I think, you know, when people are reflecting on Romania and Italy and you know, Stuttgart and all the great games, it's not just like, yeah, Jack was great. It almost brings everyone back to that time, to where they were in their life, to the people they shared it with, you know, some of whom may not be here now. And like, that's sort of a powerful legacy for Jack to leave, that he gave us all these memories. And, you know, there's a whole different discussion and debate you can have about legacies and style of play. And I appreciate that will always happen, and that's all part of the discussion. But just in the terms of like the national euphoria and celebration, and the sort of the lifelong memories that those of us can remember will carry with us no matter where you were and what part of life you were in. If you can remember that moment, you'll never forget it.
Like all the tributes from the people we've spoken to already today, Jason McAteer, Kevin Moran, Mick McCarthy, Kevin Sheedy, they're all just they all just love the man, and it's just very simple. From a human being, they just love the guy. They bought into what he was about, and he had a way of getting the best out of them. It's as simple as that, really.
Yeah, I mean, like, when you consider that the history of Irish football, part of that, I listened to John Giles and various guests, and, you know, there was a lot of near misses and sort of dramatic failures and you know, injustices, you know, and various reasons that Ireland didn't qualify for tournaments, that the breakthrough didn't happen before 88. And I mean, the whole fact that Jack in himself was a slightly, you know, chaotic appointment. Other candidates were favoured, and he ended up coming in almost through the back door at the last minute. But whatever your view of the legacy, like he got the team across the line. He had a plan. Like maybe it wasn't the most aesthetically pleasing plan, but at least he believed in something, you know. And he had a way that he wanted the team to play, and a purpose and an approach. And he made decisions. And like, management is about making decisions. Sometimes we see managers that fail because they're actually afraid to maybe leave out big characters, or, you know, you see for years, you had England trying to shoehorn Lampard and Gerrard and Scholes or whatever, and try and make it work and whatever it might be. But like, Jack came along and decided he was doing things his way. This was it. If you're Liam Brady, you don't fit into it, sorry, or whoever it might be.
David O'Leary, and, until 90.
Yeah, David O'Leary, and he went with it. And of course, like if Gary McKay doesn't score the goal in Bulgaria, we could be talking about a completely different story. But the fact is, they got the points on the board. You know, they got there, and like, I suppose the rest is history. And I don't have the personal anecdotes that people have, and I would often listen to like other, you know, journalists who were there in that era, and some of the amazing stories that they have of the access and the closeness and just how good it was. But I did, like, back in 2011, he was over the Independent. We actually had him over as a sort of to give him a merit award or a lifetime achievement award. And I did have a couple of hours in the afternoon with Jack and his wife, Pat. And listen, the mind wasn't as sharp as it was. He admitted it himself. But the one thing that sort of that really clicked him into gear was talking about going to Mexico in 1986 and watching Belgium, who were in Ireland's qualifying group. They got to the semi-finals in 86, and they, you know, they were the team to watch. And all of a sudden, like, he was, you know, he wasn't, you know, he was struggling with his recollection of certain things. But once he started talking about the way Belgium played, he was off. You know, he was off in one. And, you know, he was taking mobile phones and coffee cups and whatever, and, you know, talking about the space Belgium left behind their full backs. And he was telling Chris Morris or whoever it was to do this, and this was Houghton and this was Aldridge. And he was suddenly in the moment. Like, he was back. And Pat, who was sort of listening nearby, it was lovely. Like, you know, she was just there reading the paper. But anytime he stalled or just got a bit stuck and couldn't think of something, she would interject and try and fill the gap or whatever it was. But when he sort of got through that passage, I mentioned it in a piece earlier, she was just saying, yeah, you never stop him talking now. Like, and there was that moment of clarity that reminded you that, yes, like, we have an image of Jack in as a personality and a charismatic figure, but there was also a method to what he did, and it worked. Whether you liked it or not, and whether opponents liked it or not, it worked.
We're also joined on the line as well by Vincent Hogan from the Irish Independent, who might have been on the beat with Jack a little bit earlier than Daniel. Vincent, how are you?
Good, John.
When did you start on the beat with Jack? When did you first meet him, Vincent, do you remember?
My first time would be Italia 90, and I suppose my memory of Jack, funnily enough, I'm quite shocked to think that Jack was only 51 when he got the Irish job in 86, because he always radiated the sense of seniority. And, you know, for someone like me, be 30 in Italia 90, in his company you felt like a 16-year-old, because he had that great sense of authority. And the thing about him, John, was he always understood the force of his presence. He was a big man physically, but he had a big personality too. And I think that was the key to his management, that, you know, Daniel is touching on it there, that he had great clarity in how he wanted his team to play. But what was completely underplayed was the research he'd do on the opposition. Yes, Ireland may have had what seemed a relatively primitive system, but it was factoring in all of this information on the opposition. And you talk to any of the players who played under him, they knew exactly what their opponents wanted to do with the ball. So he was very clever like that. But the other thing that strikes me, and I don't think he gets enough credit for this, he never played the card of being a World Cup winner. He never brought that up into conversation. It was never there unsolicited. Yes, we tried to bring it up occasionally, like that day in Genoa. Inevitably, he was asked, how does this compare to 66? And actually, that day, he said, this is probably better than 66. But he never waved that flag of being a World Cup winner. And I think that's why Irish people really took to him so quickly, that there's so many different strands to Englishness, if you like. But I think particularly the northwest of England with the Scousers, the northeast with the Geordies, they have a very similar sense of humour to Irish people. And Jack had a great sense of humour. And I remember interviewing him in his hotel room in Orlando in 94. And he was pouring 2 pints of Guinness out of his private keg. And he was looking to get a particular matchup on the television. And he threw me the remote control because he was looking for his glasses, couldn't find them. And I started going through the channels, and I ended up hitting the adult movie. And if you saw his face light up immediately, he said, that's all right, we'll stay with it. It's the football we'll do later. And he had that great crack in him, even though during US 94, he was really stressed out about the heat and, you know, the style of play that Ireland played with the heat. But he had that humanity as well. And another thing that strikes me is he was very loyal, that he had a particularly close relationship with the older, more senior soccer writers, Charlie Stewart of the Irish Press, Noel Dunn of the Irish Independent, Billy George of the Examiner, Peter Byrne of the Irish Times. And I always thought he had a particularly kind relationship with Charlie. And in the mid-90s, when the press was coming towards its end and there was a lock-in of the staff in Burkee, Jack went along just, I would imagine, out of support for Charlie, to have his photograph taken in solidarity with the journalist locked in. And he just had that sense of decency about him, which I think is why people loved him.
And the access then was completely different, Vincent. And I'm sure you had a few rows, though, as well with him.
Oh, he was a desperately intimidating man. And that's what I mean by you could feel like a 16-year-old in his company. You really were very careful not to step out of line with him. And he had a great understanding of his presence in a room. And I think that's what made him such a good manager, that he could communicate that sense of authority to anyone, you know, that, and, he, you know, if you go back to the Dave O'Leary situation, and I know Dave O'Leary's family were very hurt that here was this gloriously talented centre-back with Arsenal who couldn't get a game under Jack, but Jack was very clear-cut in what he wanted from his centre-backs, and he had played alongside Bobby Moore in that England team in 66, and Clive Tilsley tells a story today on Twitter where he was giving an after-dinner speech and he was talking about the last seconds of extra time in the final against West Germany in 66. And England are 3-2 up and the ball comes to Bobby Moore. And Jack roars at him, Rosette, Rosette. And, of course, Bobby Moore never kicked one into Rosette in his life. He was this beautifully elegant centre-half. So Bobby actually dips the shoulder, cuts inside a couple of German players and hits this beautiful ball up towards Jeff Hurst. And next thing that happens, of course, is that famous commentary. They think it's all over. It is now, as Hurst gets his hat-trick. But Jack would tell that story against himself, because to him, in that situation, there was only one thing to do, and that was Rosette. I think he saw in O'Leary something similar to the Bobby Moore style of play, but he would bristle, absolutely bristle, at players getting caught in possession just on the edge of their own penalty area. You know, you see it all the time in the Premier League, Brighton against Liverpool earlier this week, two goals conceded in 8 minutes because they're just trying to play out against better, technically better players. He would have been frothing at the mouth looking at that. And that's why he preferred Kevin Moore and Mick McCarthy with Paul McGrath in front of them. His idea was you play football in the opposition half, not your own.
Do you kind of subscribe to the theory, Vincent, that, and I would, that it what Jack and the team did changed Ireland forever?
I think it changed our sense of ourselves. It changed our expectations. We were so beaten down psychologically to expecting disappointment, certainly with our soccer team. And, you know, I would think it's very important to say that he inherited a really top-class group of players from Owen Hand. And Owen Hand was a very unlucky Irish manager. And he didn't have the look that Jack had when Gary Mackay scored that goal in Sofia. But what Jack did then was he had that certainty of purpose about how he wanted the team to play. And I think Euro 88 changed everything. Not so much the national psyche, but the psyche of the players. And from that came our own sense of self, like Italia 90, US 94. We just expected that team to get results against the best teams in the world. It's often forgotten that we went to US 94 on the back of friendly wins away to Holland in Tilburg, away to Germany, I think in Hanover. And then our first game in Italia 9, or in US 94, we beat the Italians. I mean, that was the caliber of team we had at that stage. I think we were ranked 9th in the world going to that World Cup. So that was something that was unimaginable to people growing up in the 70s and 80s. And one outstanding memory for me is the day in Genoa when Dave O'Leary got the penalty to put us into the quarterfinals. I turned to go up to Noel Dunn, our soccer correspondent, who would have been roughly the same age as my dad. And like my dad at the time, was going through health problems and was really struggling with the heat at the time. And I was in the habit of just going to check on Noel to see that he was okay to do his work. And as I went up to him, he was about four rows back, he was in floods of tears. And that really brought it home to me. This guy, he was probably 20 years on the soccer beat. He never imagined he'd see a day like that. And it was Charlton's sense of certainty that brought us those days.
Dan, I'd say you'd love those days as the man in that job now.
Yeah, no, those stories are getting me going now. Like, that is the power of it. Like, you know, people obviously remember the... I've watched it already today, like the reeling in the years clip of like the the grown men in tears. Like, as I sort of mentioned it earlier on, like a generation of men who probably weren't used to crying or weren't, it was almost frowned upon maybe to cry in public so openly. I don't know, whatever the attitude might have been towards it. And, you know, listen, Vincent puts it so well there, and he lived it, he was there, he was through it. And I can only imagine, I saw someone make the point earlier on that, like, that actually it's the maybe the generation who saw football in the country before it, you know, appreciate it even more. Whereas I mentioned, like, people around my age who grew up and all of a sudden we had like three tournaments in 6 years and this was the norm. We'll never have anything like that again. Like, I don't think we ever will, because nothing beats the first time. And it's very hard to recreate. Like, the innocence sounds patronizing, but you know what I mean? It's more the sense of, like, this was raw and this was natural and, like, it was unbridled joy. Like, the scenes were, like, scenes people hadn't experienced. And again, listen, I'm not best placed to talk about it, but obviously, you know, Ireland in the 80s had its problems. And, you know, you talk to people, I think it's Declan Lynch has the book about Italia 90 and...
Yeah, we're going to have him on the show, yeah, in a little bit.
Yeah, like, you know, I don't know, like, how far you go with it in terms of what role it played and what happened afterwards for the country. But certainly it made everyone stand tall and proud, I guess. And, yeah, you'd love to think that we will have days like that again. And, I really hope that we do. But it'll always be different, you know, where it's a bit more cynical and we're a bit more aware of our surroundings now, that I'm not sure if we'll ever lose ourselves like we did in that moment. And, you know, for that, you know, generation, that older generation from a more, maybe more conservative Ireland and from a very, you know, who'd lived through some pretty challenging times and away from just football, but in life or whatever, to have that moment must have been the outpouring of emotion. Like, we're watching it as kids, wondering why, you know, getting into it, but wondering why everyone is so emotional almost. And you get it now. And you're so grateful now that you actually, you were able to see it. But I can only imagine what it was like to really feel it, having maybe lived through some of the darker days beforehand.
And 25 years of age and younger won't remember it, Vincent. You then travelled to USA 94. I mean, the Giant Stadium, these things must be just in your DNA, just even as a reporter for the rest of your life.
Oh, big time, John. And the thing that struck me was he had this really sincere, genuine connection with the supporters. And he took really serious pride in the conduct of the Irish supporters, that they could go in their thousands and spend the days drinking and never cause trouble. And what's often forgotten is the day of the famous win in the Giant Stadium, and we're all jumping around celebrating. Jack is actually running on the pitch to remonstrate with New Jersey policemen who have pinned two Irish supporters to the ground because they've run onto the pitch celebrating. And, you know, New Jersey police were not familiar with that kind of scenario of people running on a pitch celebrating. So they're pinned to the ground face first, and one of them is bleeding from the face. And Jack was absolutely outraged by this. And you know, in that moment of arguably his greatest triumph, that was what he was doing. He was remonstrating with them to go easy on the supporters that they were just celebrating. But he just had that bond. You know, it's. I was just watching a clip on Twitter earlier, and, you know, it goes back to the BBC Personality of the Year program, where his brother Bobby is getting an all-time achievement award, and they get Jack to present it. And there's a great sense of melancholy to that, because of course they didn't talk for years, and there's this kind of moment of reunion between himself and Bobby, and he looks at the trophy and he says, Bobby is the greatest player I've ever seen, and he's my brother. And you can see the emotion welling up in Bobby Charlton at that moment. So there was a sadness in him as well, that so many years went by where he didn't talk to his brother.
That is a very touching and tough day for Bobby today, Vincent. Were you at Anfield, Vincent, in 95?
Yeah, I was. Yeah. I was.
And you're a Liverpool fan, so like for a lot of reasons, that must have been an incredible night.
Yeah, it was an incredible night, but it was also, you just knew the game was up.
Yeah, the end.
Really. I think I'm right in saying, John, that night we started with something like seven defenders in the team. It was a very lopsided team. The great years had basically begun to dissipate, and Jack's personality, I think it began to dissipate with him. And there was, you know, you could sense the sadness of it. That we, I think we all knew that night at Anfield, the Dutch were way too good for us. And we all knew when we waved to the crowd at the end of that game that it was probably the end. And he went after that before he was pushed. And that was the sadness, that you could tell he had probably lost it in the sense of the magic he had brought for 10 years. It was gone at that stage. But it was gone largely because the team was gone.
Yeah. Is he a bit like Brian Clough, Vincent? Like, can a Jack work now, do you think, that kind of manager?
I don't think so. I don't think so. I think the game is evolving so constantly. I mean, we even see Mourinho at the moment. He looks like a relic of the past because the likes of Guardiola and Klopp have just brought such refinement to their game plans, and there's so much technical knowledge put into game plans, and particularly an attacking game plan. And I think that's where Jack probably would be caught short. His greatness as Ireland manager was built on making us very, very difficult to play against. Now, we did play some wonderful football at the times. I always mentioned the USSR game in 88. But one game really stands out for me is April 91, Wembley Stadium against England. We drew 1-1, but we played England off the park that night. So he it would be wrong to kind of label him as a one-dimensional kind of manager who just kick and rush. It was a lot more than that. But no, I think he was of his time, but he was brilliant of his time.
And much loved as we pay tribute to him today, Vincent.
Absolutely. You can hear it in everybody's voice. Anyone who dealt with him, you know, I would have a special interest in Paul McGrath, who's issued a really beautiful statement today.
You wrote his book, Vincent, of course, as well.
Yeah, and Paul refers to him as a father figure. And as everyone knows, Paul never met his real father. So, and Jack Charlton, when Paul was having his scrapes, was just a kind man. And a good man. And, you know, it was much less to do with football than with people when it came to Jack dealing with Paul. And Paul clearly will never forget that.
Vincent, thanks for joining us on Off the Ball Saturday.
Pleasure, John.
Vincent Hogan there from the Irish Independent. Dana McDonald is staying with us from the Irish Independent. Just read out some messages we're getting in from our listeners. I think of Jack Boom, 1990 penalty shootout, Packy saves, O'Leary scores, legged at the door, my black and white Italian 90 ball, booted against the wall, hit a nail, devastation. The highs and lows, Bill. The highs and lows. Hashtag RIP Big Jack. After living through the joys of the Jack era, I had the pleasure of meeting him in the Celtic Club in Luton in 2000. I bought him a pint of Guinness, and he was such a pleasant and down-to-earth man. The chat with him was like having a pint with your dad. When Jack was in charge, they used to come over to Carrick Cross in County Monaghan to train. You would often see the Irish team in the Fiddler's Nightclub, now owned by our own Banty. But there would be no sign of Jack. He would be out on the many lakes around Monaghan doing a second love at the time, fishing. Thanks to the memories, Jack, that is in Barry in Carrickmacross. Good stories there from Vincent, Daniel, and it really, I suppose, it is a time, it is of an era, but it was an era that spanned 10 years. And if you reach 3 tournaments, that's something we'd take anybody's arm off for now.
Oh, we'd love it. Yeah, it's funny someone mentioned Carrickmacross because I grew up with like an RG quite close, and I remember going to watch the team train. I think they trained in Dundalk sometimes as well, but in particular Carrickmacross because they'd stay in the Nuremore Hotel it was, and I have some old photos meeting Chris Hughton and a few others back in the day. But yeah, like, you know, it was unprecedented. You know, it was three tournaments in 6 years and. Like, not just sort of going to the tournaments, but actually participating in them. Particularly, like, you know, the Euro 88 campaign is still our greatest qualifying achievement. You know, it was an 8-team finals. You had to win a group to get there. And we did it. And, like, you know, that is the context that you have to put some of the previous failures in. And Vincent's right to mention Owen Hand and people who could have got there. It was way harder to qualify for stuff. You weren't finishing third in a group and going into a playoff. It was a different, you know, it was a different qualification beat. And as it happens with 90, you know, they were almost comfortable in the end going to Malta.
One thing I think about all this, Dan, is that, sorry to interrupt. We did this whole World Cup series during the pandemic. Obviously, we're trying to keep people going during that 3 months, and hopefully, you know, we're emerging from that now. Ireland were robbed so many times by bad refereeing decisions. Belgium for the 82 World Cup, France before then, Bulgaria under Johnny Giles, and that kind of thing. And when we watched the 1990 video, the official film, I think the first thing they showed was an Irish fan, and they kind of followed him throughout the tournament. I actually think us qualifying for these tournaments and the way we conducted ourselves as fans, as supporters in at Italia 90 and at the World Cup in USA 1994. The powers that be in world football, whether it's like overt or covert or whatever, wanted us there. And I think that actually is one of the legacies of Jack.
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, it's a shame they didn't want us there in 2009. But like, you know, it is true. I mean, like, I know that sometimes elements of the fan stuff can still be overplayed. Like, there is no doubt, and we see it with some of the viral videos in the, you know, in the Euros, and let's serenade some nuns and whatnot. I get that. Like, that's not for everyone. Like, people are having a good time, but I appreciate why it can also great, and maybe more so in recent years, and like, you know, Euro 2012 when the football wasn't good at all, and that was all we had. Whereas, like, back then, it was all wrapped in together. It was the fans just enjoying being there, but also a team that was contributing to the competition and actually doing stuff in the finals. And like you mentioned, you know, the 1990 World Cup video. And yeah, Corey, all this almost seems fresh because we've been in nostalgia mode all summer here on Saturdays. But the Irish contribution to that event, and particularly in light of, you know, football in the 80s, and, you know, Heysel and Hillsborough, and, you know, the ban on English fans or English clubs from Europe. And, you know, even around Italia 90 itself, there was still crowd trouble. You know, Euro 88, there was crowd trouble. Like, you look through the archives, and a lot of the front pages around that time were still almost dominated or largely influenced by that, because there was almost a constant threat and a fear. And as a result, we are condemned to this for history. We will always be associated with the English. We often get called British, whatever it might be. But our fans were a different proposition. But yet, of course, managed by an Englishman, an English hero, which is always sort of a quirky subplot to the whole thing, that we had this expression, like this outpouring, this expression of national pride and love for the country. And yet, like, you have an Englishman managing the team, and you would think there would be some kind of complications with that in some ways or whatever it might have been, but there wasn't, you know. And also as well, again, you know, you can talk about the legacy of the era and style of play and all this stuff, none of which was Jack's fault. Like, he was there to do his job, to do the best thing he could. He exploited the grandparent rule, like, you know, better than anyone before. But that almost added to the connection in some ways, because a lot of those players, like, they were the first and second generation. They're from the families of, like, the Irish people who really had to emigrate due to really, like, pressing, dire, you know, economic need. And so that gave it probably the diaspora part of the story as well. And I always, of all the stories I'll never get tired, to be honest. I know people get sick of nostalgia, but I'll never get tired of listening to some of the stories of Euro 88 and Italia 90. I've read some stuff recently about what it was like, I think, to be Irish in London during that time, what that must have been. And the fact that Jack was a World Cup winner, it all just wraps into it. It all wraps into the whole magic aspect of that story.
Yeah, well, I don't think it's the only thing we really should be doing today is talking about how great Jack was, and what we should be doing is reminiscing today. Absolutely. We'll speak to Dan after the break. Just to let you know, it's Liverpool 0, Burnley 0 after half an hour in the Premier League earlier. It ended Norwich 0, West Ham 4. So Norwich have been relegated, Watford 2, Newcastle 1. So Watford and West Ham looking pretty safe, with Bournemouth and Aston Villa in trouble in the Premier League. Just to mention, we've teamed up as well with 20 by 20 to give our listeners a chance to win 3 weeks of training, advice and mentoring from the Mayo and AFL legend Sarah Rowe. To enter our competition, just send us a 10-second video telling us what training you'll be doing and why you should win. WhatsApp the video into the OTB WhatsApp number. That's 087-9180-180. 087-9180-180. It's all part of the No Proving, Just Moving campaign, encouraging women to get active, and is the latest chapter in the 20 by 20 movement, which is hooked around the benefits of participation, highlighting that being active and moving is a gift that you can only give yourself. This is only open to women and girls, so boys, pass it on to the women in your life, please, and we'll select the winner on Monday, so be sure to get those entries in. More tributes to Jack Charlton between now and 5 o'clock. You've got to take a break. Back after this.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. When you've watched more Belarusia Premier League than is healthy, proper football is back. Gamble responsibly. See WWE.net.
Future of Work
with Jess Kelly and Gavin McLaughlin.
On the latest Future of Work, we take a look at the role remote work hubs will play as we continue to adjust to the new normal. Kent Oban of the Tralee Chamber Alliance and Sarah Daly of Creative Spark in Dundalk join us to discuss.
Future of Work
with Jess Kelly and Gavin McLaughlin.
Thanks to Vodafone Business.
Listen and subscribe to the podcast now on newstalk.com or tune in Saturday at 7.
On Newstalk.
Petrol or electric? Petrol or electric? Why choose? With the range of BMW plug-in hybrid electric vehicles, you can experience the pure excitement of both. Two power sources combined for a single source of driving joy. And always BMW. Embrace the road ahead in a new BMW plug-in hybrid electric vehicle. Explore the range at your local BMW retailer or at discoverbmw.ie.
Afternoons are easy with InsureMyVan.ie, Ireland's low-cost van insurance specialists. Get your business back on the road with InsureMyVan's best price guarantee. For super savings, visit InsureMyVan.ie. City Financial Marketing Group Limited, training as InsureMyVan.ie, is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
It's a rainy day, not too far from now. You're about to do a team call. Another one. But Louth, you think about the promise you made with the lads. Fishing. The meet-up for the big 4-0. Maybe Alaska. You think somebody will be doing it? Some lucky divils. You think about buying a lotto ticket. Why wouldn't you? And perhaps then you'd remember Louth has had more millionaire winners for its size than any other county. How would you know that? Well, maybe you heard it somewhere. And maybe then you think, if someone's going to win it, why not me? The National Lottery. It could be you. Play responsibly. Play for fun.
Everyone can join Ireland's fight against coronavirus by downloading the HSE's COVID Tracker app. It helps reduce the spread of the virus in Ireland while protecting your privacy and keeping a secure, anonymous record of people you're in close contact with. It can alert you if you've been in close contact with someone who tests positive and helps us with contact tracing if you become ill. So the more people who use the app, the more people we can protect. Stay safe. Protect each other. Download the HSE's COVID Tracker app at covidtracker.ie.
Escape to the country at Mount Wolseley Hotel Spa and Golf Resort. Enjoy alfresco dining in blissful gardens, a woodland walking trail, an 18-hole championship golf course, a forest playground complete with zip wire, extensive leisure facilities and award-winning spa. Four-star luxury in a safe, serene and beautiful country resort. Choose a deluxe room or book a four-star resort house, offering 20% sale across a wide range of exclusive of summer packages. MountWolseley.ie for your perfect escape.
PowerCity stores are open for customer service and the collection of online orders. So please shop online at powercity.ie, select click and collect, or make use of our home delivery service. For more information, go online to powercity.ie.
The switching revolution continues at Carphone Warehouse with deals you won't find anywhere else. Get the Huawei P30 Pro and a GT smartwatch for just $49.99 on a €40 a month plan with Vodafone, now with unlimited data, but only when you switch at Carphone Warehouse. And get the brand new Samsung S20 5G free when you switch to a Vodafone €60 a month plan with unlimited data. So get into your local Carphone Warehouse store and join the switching revolution today. T's and C's apply, offer subject to availability and 24-month contract.
Going boating or angling this summer? Better check the weather in advance. Better that you don't go alone. Better to know local currents and tides. Better to always wear a life jacket on or near water. This is Water Safety Ireland. Better safe than sorry. For advice, visit watersafety.ie, an initiative of the Government of Ireland.
Petrol, diesel, hybrid, plug-in hybrid, electric, which one do you choose? At the Society of the Irish Motor Industry, we're here to help. We know different drivers have different needs, so we provide clear, simple advice on the benefits of each technology. Whether you're buying a new 202 or a used car, talk to your local SIMI retailer. Drive cleaner, drive greener. To find out more, visit simi.ie/drivegreener.
Right team, now that we are experts in bread baking and homeschooling, we have a number of business priorities. Update our workplace, floors and walls with safety signage, install sanitising stations and kickstart our marketing. So let's get started. Call Snap.
Trust Snap to deliver on time and on budget across COVID-19 safety signage and display, information videos, web and graphic design and future marketing campaigns. You say health and safety across your business, we say talk to snap.ie.
At National College of Ireland, our students are living proof that studying here can help boost your career.
NCI is absolutely a welcoming place. People from all walks of life come here, and everyone is treated the same.
It gives you an opportunity to step back into learning and to make a real change in your life. I think that NCI gave me a real pathway to success.
Yeah, I'd recommend NCI because of its commitment to helping students progress their careers. Yes, I'm living proof that NCI is the best career move you can make.
Prove to yourself what you can do with our wide range of full and part-time courses at National College of Ireland. Call 1850 221 721 or visit ncirl.ie.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power.
When you've done your hammer during PE with Joe, relax. The football's back.
Gamble responsibly. See dunleary.net.
And you're welcome back to Off the Ball Saturday on News Talk. John Duggan with you through to 5 o'clock. A special show paying tribute to Jack Charlton, who's very sadly passed away at the age of 85, the former Republic of Ireland manager. You can text us on 53106. You can tweet us at Off the Ball. You can watch us on our social channels as well for Periscope, on the new OTB Sports app, on YouTube, on Facebook. We've got Dan McDonald from the Irish Independent with us until 5 o'clock. Just some texts here. At the reach of soccer, my girlfriend and I met a Shaolin monk in Bangkok in 1994 who invited us back to his temple to talk. I feared a scam and being mugged, but I was outvoted. We sat on the grass and explained we were from Ireland. Blank stare from the monk. We had a copy of the Bangkok Post, which had the IRA ceasefire, again a blank stare. Then we saw light in his eye when we said, green jersey, then Jack Charlton. We love Ireland. He knew more about the team than we did, even though he didn't know where Ireland was. He loved us because of Jack. That is from Brian and Carla. Lovely text there on 53106. I'm joined on the line with Daniel by Declan Lynch, the journalist and the author of Days of Heaven, Italian 90 and the Charlton Years, Irish Soccer's Finest Hour. Declan, good afternoon.
Hi, John.
Thanks for joining us, Declan. And I say it's a very sad day for us all, but especially for you as well, Declan, given you got immersed yourself so much in this with that great book. I have it at home, chronicling the days that the best days of our lives, I suppose, under Jack.
Yeah, it was a strange book. It was supposed to be for the 20th anniversary of Italia 90, and was supposed to come out when Ireland had qualified for the 2010 World Cup, except there was a slight problem with that we Thierry didn't actually Henry, qualify yeah. for this. Yeah. So I feel that I personally suffered more than from Thierry Henry than almost any other living being. But it was an extraordinary thing just looking back, because it was such an important time in Ireland generally, and Jack was such a part of that. I mean, it's at some level, it's the happiest story ever in Irish history almost, right? Okay, Italia 90 and everything to do with that. And Jack is there. I mean, he's a huge figure, really, in recent Irish history, definitely. So, and oddly enough, a lot of our major iconic figures, they tend to be associated with just tragic events or things that didn't turn out so well or that left a terrible legacy or whatever. Whereas, in a very large sense, it's kind of all good, you know? It was such a great time. The Italian 90 episode, generally, there's almost nothing bad you can say about it. Do you know what I mean? You can quibble with some of the football here and there, but as an event, and as a national kind of event, it was just great, you know?
The plane was called Saint Jack, I remember, coming back from Italy, or was it, I think it was either Germany or Italy, but I believe it was Italy.
Yeah.
Did you ever encounter Jack, Declan, even though you wrote about it? Did you ever meet him? Did you ever spend time with him? Or?
Yeah, I interviewed him for Hot Press.
Yeah.
Not long after he actually took the job. And it was kind of funny because we kind of forget that Jack was only in his 50s. He was quite in his, I think, he wasn't all that old. He still seemed older than he actually was, you know. And he just got the job. The memory I have of him, he was very energetic and very kind of businesslike, you know. He was out in the hotel, the airport hotel, and the Mick Byrne was there, kind of, you know, busy, you know, buzzing around and, you know, preparing things and all this. And Jack expected a woman to come and interview him, which is kind of just an odd, because it was a woman in Hot Press who had arranged it, I think, right? And so he was kind of taken aback. Oh, I thought you were supposed to be a woman, you know? So there was this bit of back and forth as I apologize for not being a woman, you know? And And then he was grand, and he, you know, in that way that Jack has, he would be referring to Bulgaria as Romania, that sort of thing, right? And you, something would go on you, and you just think, look, if he doesn't kind of know it at this stage, it doesn't matter. And he, we know what he means, and he knows what he means, so who cares, you know? But he always had that funny sort of thing that, like, generated a lot of humour, you know, that he didn't really bother much about those kind of... You often hear it, actually, sometimes with... even with, say, John Giles or Eamon Dunphy, that they know who they're talking about, like. You know what I mean? Like, so it doesn't actually matter that too much that they're kind of tripping over some of the details like that. But one of the main things that came out of that interview, I remember, was that he was around that time in Ireland, there was a lot of farmers were poisoning the lakes with slurry. And remember, they used to be emptying slurry into the river. And Jack is a great fisherman, was outraged by this. And probably his most powerful kind of statement in the course of the interview was just how outraged he was about all this, and what great lakes you have in Ireland, and that it was a real shame, a real disgrace that this was happening, you know. So that sticks in my mind as being one of the main things of it, you know. But he was really nice, you know what I mean? He was like, you know, he wasn't long in the job. And one of the things that had emerged early on was, I remember the match with Belgium away. I think it was Belgium. I may be getting like that. Maybe it was Holland. No, I think it was Belgium. And we got a penalty more or less in the last minute, and which had never happened. And we just got this weird sense that this guy might be lucky. You know, Jack had brought a bit of luck with him that we had never had before. Like, I think it's almost impossible to convey this. When I was writing the book as well, to wade back through the horrors of Ireland trying to qualify for European Championships and World Cups, and the amount of times they were just simply cheated out of it, you know, openly cheated, right, was absolutely extraordinary. And that gave us a lot of kind of scar tissue. That we just believed that no matter what happened, we'd never get our due. And Jack, you see, had none of that. He had won the World Cup, like, you know. So he almost had the opposite. Like, Jack dealing with, you know, other great nations of the world would never feel inferior, you know. Whereas we always felt we were going to get done. So maybe just simply by having someone like that from outside who didn't have all our... I think that was a big thing as well.
So you're an Athlone Town fan, Declan, and you know, as a journalist, you know, when you're following the thread of Ireland as a soccer fan and a journalist between, say, 86 and 96 with Jack Charlton, did you enjoy it? Was the winning that all that mattered? The style of play? How did you come to terms with it in a beautiful way, or did you just battle with it at all, or did you just ride the wave of this incredible journey?
Oh, no, I mean, I loved it, you know. I mean, like, my father used to take me up to see Ireland playing in Dalymount, you know, when I was very young. And, it was just this... there were great occasions and all that, but you never expected to get anywhere. Do you know what I mean? Like, Ireland were always... There was always this barrier between us and the next phase, if you like, you know? So we had internalised that failure, really. And, you know, to actually... just qualify was such a thing. I mean, I was there in the international bar the day that Scotland scored against Bulgaria. There was just a couple of us there looking at it on telly, and not expecting anything. We had already given up. Like, I think maybe that's part of the psychology. You know, only when you completely despair do things sort of start to happen. You know, for that to, it was so weird and so mad the way Ireland qualified for the first time that it was a really important thing. Just psychologically, to actually get to one of these things, what was huge. Like, Ireland had always had good players and good teams, but they had nothing else. They had no luck. They had no kind of tradition of doing well. And those are really hard things to get past, you know. So to actually be getting a few breaks of the ball and getting a bit of success being qualifying for the European Championships. I mean, in 1988, there were only eight teams in the finals. It was a really big deal, like, you know. So it was an enormous psychological boost.
How will Jack be remembered for you, Declan?
Oh, with a huge fondness, you know. I mean, there were all sorts of arguments you could make with Jack or you know, against the way he sort of played. But, like, one of the things that he brought was, you know, just a kind of a certainty or a... Like, all managers have ways of playing, right? Or they have, like, sort of ideas. But Jack was particularly kind of clear. And I often think that, like, players really like that. Do you know what I mean? Like, it almost doesn't matter what the manager is saying, as long as what he's saying is clear. And he knows, at least, what he wants. Like, you know, everything else is sort of hypothetical. We've always had good players. People say, oh, with the players we had, we could have done a lot better. But we'd always had good players, and we got nowhere. You know, like, if anything, we had better players before Jack. And it never worked out because of maybe that scar tissue I was talking about, just the psychological issues. And like, whatever Jack brought to it, you know, everybody there knew what was expected of them and knew what he wanted them to do, you know. And that's a really big thing. I think that's... That just as a manager, that's ultimately what you need to do. And he made a huge contribution, and they were the best days of our lives for many of us. Sure, how on earth would we not have, you know, think of them? Great affection, you know.
Yeah, Declan. Well, thanks for sharing your memories with us today.
Sure.
Declan Lynch, your book Days of Heaven, Italian 90 in the Charlton Years, Irish Soccer's Finest Hour, definitely worth a read. I have it at home myself. I think he's hit the nail on the head there, Dan. About the fact that sometimes you need to make your own luck.
Oh, listen, absolutely. And, you know, there is very few football stories in history that don't involve it in some shape or form, you know, and like 1966, maybe, you know, but it doesn't matter. Like, you know, it's how you move on from it or how you sort of react to it. And there was luck at the start. There is no doubt in terms of getting to 88. But they went from there, and yeah, like, it ran its course in the end.
Well, everything does.
Exactly. And like you touched on it with Vincent, you know, that it's very hard actually for, you know, for any managerial careers now to even go longer than a decade and to stay in one place and with one team. I know Yogi Love is doing it with Germany at the moment, but in an international game, it's pretty rare. Everything's very transient. Everyone's always moving on. It's a 2-year gig and then almost you're done sometimes. So yeah, listen, that is a part of it, and I got really struck by, like, you know, Declan's conclusion there. It's the best days of a lot of people's lives, and it's all part of the debate to talk about how his team operated and played because it was distinctive. But as I said, like, he was hired to do that. Like, if you ever had any issue with it, he was never going to change. Like, I did a piece recently for a series we did with Chris Waddle, who had been managed by Jack at Newcastle. And at one point went in one day and said to Jack, you know, could you not play in a different way? You've got me, you've got Peter Beardsley, you know, can we not play in a slightly different style? I'll drop in, pick up the ball, run at players. And Jack was like, no. Like, this was, he had an idea about how the game was going to be played, and that was it. And once he's given the job, you've hired the person to do that job. And he came and he did it. And,
Even Gascoigne had promised first under Jack Charlton? You just don't know.
Yeah,
he could have paid for us.
He was coming through at the time. Although I think Jack always spoke fondly of Gazza and said he might have found a way to use him. Maybe, I don't know. I mean, like, Ronnie Whelan was one of the great players. Is one of the great players of Irish football history. I'm very underrated, actually. You know, given where he was with Liverpool, and I don't think he ever necessarily maybe loved playing in Jack's teams in terms of how they played, but he adapted to it, and everyone had to adapt to his style. But again, like, that's management. It's about making decisions. Sometimes managers don't make decisions at all, and I completely understand that. I wonder where I would have been on it back in the day with, you know, the way that they played, and obviously there was very vocal critics, and I completely understand, and they were, you know, they were right to say what they felt, and that the, you know, I you have to endorse and justify anyone who has those opinions. But the fact is, the man who was responsible for the team, his way of doing things was very clearly defined. He wasn't going to change, and I guess from his perspective, the end justified the means.
We're back with you after 4 o'clock. Daniel McDonald there from the Irish Independent, speaking about Jack Charlton, our tribute to him this afternoon until five. He's very sadly passed away at the age of 85, the former Republic of Ireland manager. Some texts and tweets in here. A text on 53106. Ireland were struggling under Jack early on, and the fans and the press were beginning to lose faith. But my brother Niall wrote in the Irish Independent supporting Jack to the Irish Indo and saying we could still qualify for Euro 88. 3 days later, a letter arrived saying, signed by Jack, thanking him for support and telling him to keep faith. What a lovely gesture that was by Jack. It made my brother's day. Both were proved right in the end too. That is from Declan. And always great stories where Jack and the team would drink in a pub, and when the bills to be settled, they would pay by cheque. It was always framed and never cashed. Of course, that was the pub's decision at the time. Liverpool 1-0 up on Burnley at half-time in the Premier League. Andy Robertson scoring for the champions in the first half. More on Off the Ball Saturday on News Talk after this. At Off the Ball on Twitter, 53106, your text messages, your tributes to Jack Charlton.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power.
When you've seen West Ham beat Preston in the 1963 FA Cup final for the sixth time, live football is back.
Gamble responsibly. CWE.net.
QuoteDevil.ie can save you money on your car insurance, van insurance, or home insurance. QuoteDevil Home Insurance is so easy. Get a quote in just 60 seconds and purchase cover in 3 minutes.
The QuoteDevil's always got one hell of a quote.
QuoteDevil Limited is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
Responsible business owners. We need to create safe working environments for our staff and clients. EMS Copiers are providing managed print and IT for over 50 years and have developed a special back-to-business bundle. For €20 plus VAT per week, EMS will supply a thermal scanner to verify everyone's temperature in a contactless manner, automatically record results for contact tracing, and to forego future business disruption. Mention News Talk to bundle a free €300 sanitising station and defer your first payment to October. Call 01 901 8386 or email sales at emscopiers.ie and we'll do the rest.
It's time to answer the call.
Hey, Olaf, maybe just one of you should do it.
I agree. She's a little pitchy.
Frozen 2 is now available on Disney Plus.
It's the end.
Experience the enchanted adventure.
Promise me we do this together.
I promise.
Of the number one animated movie of all time.
This is it. Everyone ready?
I'll bring the snacks.
Frozen 2, now streaming on Disney Plus, the home of Frozen. 18 plus subscription required, T's and C's apply.
Hi, I'm Johnny O'Sullivan from Hudson Bay and Sheraton at Lone Hotels. With our comprehensive Safe Stay code in place to ensure your safety and comfort, now is the time to make a break for Athlone. There's something for everyone, from Athlone Castle and Clonmacnoise to Bay Sports and Viking Cruises on Loch Ree. Book now on hudsonbayhotel.com or sheratonathlonehotel.com, and we look forward to seeing you soon.
Hi, I'm Carmel from Athlone Castle. This summer, make a break for Athlone's hidden heartlands. The medieval town with hidden gems, from a craft brewery to Ireland's oldest pub and award-winning restaurants. And of course, shopping with Ireland's biggest retail brands. Visit athlone.ie at the heart of summer staycations.
At Guaranteed Irish, we believe enterprise is at the heart of thriving communities.
Which is why we support Original Irish Hotels, Ireland's largest collection of independent hotels, castles and manor house hotels. These hotels offer a truly local experience, employing local people and supporting local food producers. We call on you to support Original Irish Hotels when you travel again. Guaranteed Irish welcomes companies that are altogether better choices for our communities. So look out for it. GuaranteedIrish.ie. Altogether better.
PPENow.ie is here to help Irish businesses get back to work. With 30 years' experience in medical and pharmaceutical supplies, PPENow.ie delivers quality PPE to companies across Ireland at the best prices. We also provide free training, tutorials and advice on the products you need. Order now and avail of our free next-day delivery option at PPENow.ie.
This summer at Centra, we have everything you need for that Tan Thursday ritual. For 1 week only, Dove Dermaspa Summer Revived Gradual Tan 200ml was £9.75, now only €3. When it's gone, it's gone. Hashtag Tan Thursday. Centra. Live every day. Selected stores only.
At Volkswagen Financial Services, our solutions are expertly engineered to put you in the driving seat. Choose the flexibility of PCP, low-cost HP finance, or the convenience of leasing. Add extras like servicing and maintenance plans. For Volkswagen, Audi, Skoda, SEAT or Volkswagen commercial vehicles, discover financing options that match your needs and your budget. Talk to your local dealer or visit vwfs.ie/affordability. Volkswagen Financial Services. Affordability engineered for you. Finance provided by Volkswagen Financial Services Ireland. Subject to lending criteria, terms and conditions apply. Going boating or angling this summer? Better check the weather in advance. Better that you don't go alone. Better to know local currents and tides. Better to always wear a life jacket on or near water. This is Water Safety Ireland. Better safe than sorry. For advice, visit watersafety.ie, an initiative of the Government of Ireland.
As the new government commits to abolishing direct provision, Newstalk examines the much-debated system.
I never really thought this would hit me so hard.
I had to pack my life into two suitcases.
Living in a room with a family of six is not easy.
Ahead of an independent report into the scheme, we bring you Into the System. Hear from those living in accommodation centres, ask what might replace it, and find best international practice. The truth about direct provision. This summer on Newstalk.
On 106 to 108 FM.
On Newstalk.com.
On smart speaker.
And on the Newstalk app. This is Newstalk.
It's 4 o'clock. Good afternoon. I'm Stephen Burke. The president has described Jack Charlton as a man who quickly became a legendary sporting icon. Tributes have been paid to the 85-year-old who passed away at his home in England last night after a battle with lymphoma and dementia. The former Republic of Ireland manager led the country's football team to the 1988 European Championships as well as two World Cups in the 90s. Legendary footballer John Giles says he was a great man.
I would regard Jack as a very, very good friend. I might have been critical on television of Jack and his football philosophy. That's by the way. I never fell out with Jack. Jack never fell out with me. The last time I saw him was probably about 7 or 8 months ago. I always regarded Jack as a very, very good friend, and condolences to Pat and the rest of the family.
Phase 4 of easing COVID-19 restrictions could be delayed beyond the 20th of the month. It's understood the recent rise in cases, particularly among young people, is causing concern about a potential second wave. Dr. Ray Wally from the GP Expert Advisory Group says there's evidence people are becoming complacent.
The individuals who are presenting are actually presenting 5 or 6 days into this, where they presented with some of the symptoms, be it a cough, be it a fever, be it shortness of breath, loss of smell, loss of taste. So, you know, people need to be ringing the GP.
Almost half of people currently on mortgage payment breaks may not be able to start repaying their loan in October. Since March, close to 62,500 households affected by the pandemic have taken payment holidays. But mortgage broker Michael Dowling says up to half won't be ready to restart their payments.
Well, unfortunately, we're going to have significant numbers of people who'll have no job to go back to after the current pandemic.
And the decision to reopen the perimeter gates of Dublin's Phoenix Park to car traffic has been met with major criticism. The change was ordered despite the OPW stating just last week the park roads were being kept free for people to socially distance while walking and cycling. Green Party MEP Ciarán Cuff says the OPW should reconsider the move.
There always has to be a balance between the needs of traffic and the needs of people and families. But I think in this instance, the OPW have blinked and they've gone too far in the opposite direction.
It's 2 minutes past four.
News Talk weather.
Thanks to the AA. Download the new AA app to request a roadside rescue and track the patrol right to your car.
Mainly dry with a mix of cloud and sun, the best of that in the south of the country. Top temperatures of 15 to 20 degrees. And now you're up to date on News Talk.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power.
When you've seen West Ham beat Preston in the 1963 FA Cup final for the sixth time, live football is back.
Gamble responsibly. CWE.net.
And this is Off the Ball Saturday on News Talk with John Duggan through to 5 o'clock. Dan McDonald from the Irish Independent is on the line with us until five. We're giving us time really aside now for the rest of the show. We've been doing it all day as well for the special tribute to Jack Charlton, who's very sadly passed away at the age of 85. The former Republic of Ireland manager led us to two World Cups, European Championship. On the show already today, we've had Kevin Moran, Mick McCarthy, Jason McAteer, John Giles, Kevin Sheedy, Vincent Hogan and Declan Lynch. And you'll get all that material on the podcast network of OTB Sports on our new app. You can download the app now for iOS and Android and listen back to some of the great tributes that we've had from footballing legends on this very sad day for the country. I just want to kind of bring you some texts and tweets that we've had in, such a variety of great tributes from the public here. Jason Ryan brought the Republic of Ireland, this is what Jack did, from relative obscurity to one of the top teams in the world under his management. I remember us beating Brazil in 1987, something else. Failed the leaving because of Jack in Italia 90. Thanks for the memories. Rest in peace. I lived in a cottage in Stony Batter during Italia 90. My bedroom was at the front, and every morning I was woken up by a man walking past on the footpath right outside my window, whistling the tune to Ole, 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 Ole. We're all part of Jackie's army, well, we certainly are today. Will Holden, as a Liverpool fan, I'm delighted that we play what's called Jurgen Preston. Jack teams played Charlton Preston. It was no surprise Ireland played so well. A friend of mine lives in Ballina. His house backed onto Jack Charlton's house where I used to stay when fishing in Mayo. In light of saying, my friend called his house Charlton View in honour of the great man. Absolute legend who gave us all great pride in ourselves as a nation. Rest in peace. The Irish maths exam was on the same day as the Romania game. Place was empty after 30 minutes. Amazing scenes in Athlone after the match. Great times. That is from Jason in Galway. Kieran O'Malley on Twitter, something poignant about crossing the River Moy to play soccer today, listening to the beautiful tributes to Jack Charlton and Off the Ball this afternoon. A love of soccer inspired by Jack's teams. Hashtag RIP Jack. Jai Rose on YouTube, RIP, the great Jackie Charlton, the world of football in mourning, respect for a massive personality from Athens, Greece. Memory of Jack Charlton, summer of 88, staying in my grandmother in West Cork, I managed to persuade her to upgrade her TV rental, black and white TV, to Philips 21 colour inch for the Euros, watching Ireland beat England 1-0 in full colour. And the man who put the ball in the English net in Stuttgart is on the line. Ray Howden, good afternoon.
Hi, John.
Sad day for you, Ray. Really sad day, and we're sorry. He was a great man.
Yeah, he was a great man. You're absolutely right. And all the tributes that you've had today from all the variety of people is worthy of the man, isn't it? You know, he was an absolute legend. That word is overused, as we know, but not for Jack. You know, when you think of his career with Leeds United and what he achieved there, and obviously going on with England to win the World Cup in 66, there were plenty of tried before it with England and plenty of tried it afterwards, but they're the only team that done it in 66, so they should be well rewarded for that. And obviously what he did with Ireland when he came in, and the transformation in the country and the way football was viewed, if you like, after that.
Oxford United in the 80s, Ray, how did this all happen with you and Jack?
Yeah, in 1985, I was playing for Oxford against Aston Villa in the League Cup first leg. And actually, Jack had come to watch John Aldridge. He knew that John had a connection with Ireland. Obviously, he was on the lookout for new faces to come in for his first game against Wales the following year. So he was just looking for new players. And after the game, one or two of the reporters had said to Jack that I was eligible because of my father was born in Donegal. So he asked me to come and join the national setup. It's actually quite funny because he said to me, I'll give you a couple of days to think it over. And I said, that's fine, yeah, that's great. I'll go and speak to my girls and my father. 9 o'clock the next morning, the phone went, and then there's Jack on the line saying, have you made your mind up? And I said, what happened a couple of days, Jack? He said, I can't wait that long, I need the answer now. And of course I said yes, and it was the best decision I ever made. I mean, he really transformed my career, and you know, went on to Liverpool after that as well, and had European champions and two World Cups. You know, it was a phenomenal time to be part of that Irish setup.
What was it like coming over to Dublin at the time, playing with the lads in that European campaign, and then going off to Germany for the first one?
Yeah, absolutely superb. And you know, we talk about Jack, and you know, the lads, I'm sure, have all been telling you stories of things that went on. But what we don't talk at times is his tactical nous. And if you think back to the qualification for 1988, we actually went to Scotland and we played with Paul McGrath at right back and Ronnie Whelan at the left back. And that was to nullify the two wingers. I think they might have been Pat Nevin and certainly David Cooper, was in great form for Rangers. And he was the one that everyone was, you know, talking about in the build-up to the game and how he can win the Scotland. So Jack just changed the team selection, if you like, the day before. We hadn't practiced it. There was no prior knowledge he was going to do it, but that was what he went with. And I think David Cooper got brought off at half-time. He had such a bad game, and Big Paul had done so well against him. But, you know, that was one of the things. But that's just tactical awareness. He knew where the strength of that Scotland team was and how he wanted to nullify it.
When I spoke to Kevin Sheedy earlier on the show, Ray, I asked him, did Jack send to him after he put the ball in the English net in 90? Did he send to you after 88? Did he need to?
Well, what he said to me in 88 was, don't ever do that again. I really thought you meant score against England, to be honest. He said, no, don't score that early. He said, that was the longest 84 minutes of my life. So, that was technical, Jack. He had great humour, great humility. He was a very humble man, but a very wise man at the same time. I think the thought character was, John, you'd be in a room, 300 people in there could be chatting away. The doors would open, Jack Charlton would walk in, and everyone would go silent. Because there's that much respect for him.
Ray, can I just come in there? Because I think it's Dan McDonald here, Ray. I think you've experienced so many great sides of Jack, but I think you told us a story before about Wembley in 1991, which is like one of the great Irish performances. Unfortunately, one time you didn't put the ball in the English net, but Jack cut you down afterwards, I believe. I think you.
Oh, Daniel, I told you that story. It's absolutely true, wasn't it? You know, obviously I'm missing an absolute sitter to win the game. And, you know, after the match, I was waiting for Jack to come in and berate me and tell me off with one thing and another. So after the match, I've got into the changing room, not a word. I jump into the big bath at Wembley, which I can actually go under. He only came up to Niall's waist, but me, I could go right under. And I was hiding from him, got my tracksuit on, sneaked out, went up to the players' lounge, very impressed that I got away with any of what I was telling off of him. Only to find the door was banging, and then I could see this apparition, which was Jack Charlton at the end of the room, and it was a massive big bar that we were in, and he'd only had eyes for me. People were going up and congratulating him. Mr. Charlton, when your team done very well this evening, it was a good result for him, and he's just shaking their hands, being a bit polite, but he's just got eyes transfixed on me, and he come marching across, and he just gave me the look, you could have been a hero again, how did you miss that? And he's screaming at me, everyone's listening, and I'm just nodding my head. He walked away. My wife said to me, you're going to let him speak to you like that? I said, after that message, he can say what he wants to me. And that was a true story.
But when it came to the Giant Stadium, Ray, you put it in the net then?
Well, I did. But he said to me, and he said afterwards, he said he didn't mean that because he doesn't know the kick we play. He's never won for praise, in fairness, at times like that. But it was all tongue-in-cheek. You know, I knew, like, there were only four people in my life who would call me Raymond. My mum and dad, my wife, and Jack Charlton.
We've heard so much love today, Ray, for the fact that he was just what you see is what you got. And he told you how to play. You played the way he asked you to play. And the rest of the time, it was light and shade. It was a bit of fun. And you enjoyed the wins, and you worked hard, and you played hard.
One of the things, one of his great attributes that he had, John, and he had quite a few, but one of them was he treated you like men. He understood as players, as a former player. And by the way, he came from a Leeds team that had real top quality players and hard men, if you like, who knew how to look after themselves off, on and off the pitch, if you know what I mean. And he wanted us to be like that. He wanted a group really tight knit because we didn't have hundreds of players to call upon. You know, we had a small group of players that we were reliant on game after game, and Jack was very loyal on most occasions with the players. But he wanted that bond, he wanted that spirit, and he would try and enforce it upon us, saying that you're all together, you're as one. When you go out there, we're a team, and I think that was hugely important for the success that we had. And listen, and Daniel will tell you, he didn't suffer fools lightly. I mean, if you were a press lad and you ask a silly question, he'd let you know, Daniel. He wouldn't let you off, would he? He would turn and tell you, no uncertain terms.
I didn't experience it really, but I've heard it. But I'm actually wondering, like, and Vincent Hogan mentioned this earlier on. He said that all the times, like, you know, Jack was a World Cup winner, but he never really brought it up. He wasn't. Yeah. You see some managers who can't help but talk about what they did. I'm kind of wondering, like, as to players, did he speak much about his own career, what he did, what he achieved? Did he tell stories, or was that something that he left out of any discussions with you guys?
Oh, that's a great point, you know. He never mentioned that. And funny enough, I actually went up to interview him at his house about 5-6 years ago. It might be a little bit longer, but around about that time. And I've never seen a World Cup winner's medal before. So I said to him, have you got your medal in the house? And he said, yeah. Do you want to see it? I said, oh, I'd love to see it. So he went upstairs and he came down a few minutes later and he brought down a little box which you get from any hardware store for about £3. And I said to him, you've not got your World Cup medal in there. And he went, yeah, here you are. And he just opened up this little box with a little key in it, opened it up, and there was his, I think it was the FA Cup, the league title, and his World Cup winner's medal in this little box. And I thought, perfectly there. There's no ills and graces about him. He's just a very humble man, working class background. But what a fella.
Did he speak, Ray, about how the game changed and how international football then progressed with Mick and with, you know, World Cup 2002 and the subsequent managers to that, and the way the Irish team might not have reached the heights that it did under him, and the way the Premier League emerged, and the way football has changed, and the money influx into the game, and the fact that it's become a global league. Did you ever have a chat with him about how things moved on after he left?
Yeah, do you know, one of the things, John, he loved Ireland. You know, he had houses, as you said, in Ballybodden, and one thing, he loved his fishing, he loved his shooting. I mean, he was revered in Ireland. I think, didn't he get the freedom of Dublin at one stage? And I think, you know, there were so many awards that he received over there. It was a major part of his life. So, yeah, he had a really keen eye on what was going on with the international team, and obviously he wanted them to be every bit as successful, or even more successful than we were. And that was what his ambition was. He loved football. Once it's in your blood, like he was, you know, you can't switch it off. If you've been a manager when Middlesbrough was in Newcastle, Sheffield Wednesday, the Republic of Ireland, when you've been a manager that long, you know, you just don't, you just stop thinking about it. I'm sure he still, you know, was very keen on what was going on internationally, domestically. He still went to games because I was asking about it. He was still going to Newcastle a few years ago to watch matches. He still, for me, was still in love with the game. He still loved what it was about. And he had, don't forget, he had an incredible career at Leeds United. Have a look back at the number of games that he played, and people tend to forget that. And I'm sure Johnny, I remember Johnny, I don't know if he mentioned it. I think you said you had Johnny on today. I don't know if he mentioned it. But Johnny said that there was a time with Leeds that was the best centre-half in England at that particular time. And that's high praise from Johnny.
How will he be remembered, Ray, do you think, in this country?
Well, I hopefully, John, with great affection, you know, and with great respect, because, you know, he came in at a time where we hadn't qualified. We had some fantastic players before Jack qualified. We had some fantastic managers. We just never got that rub of the green, if you like. They didn't have that little bit of luck, but we certainly had it, you know, when Scotland went to Bulgaria and got that win, which got us qualified. But I think most people in Ireland will have great affection for him, because, you know, there wasn't a bad bone in him. You know, he was just a lovely fella. He always had time for people. He loved his pint of Guinness. He loved his little whiskey, you know, that. He loved his little dram. And he was just a great character. And I'm sure that came across to the Irish public.
Well, Ray Houghton, you're an absolute gentleman for joining us on Off the Ball Saturday on News Talk here today. Thanks so much for paying your tribute to Jack Charlton.
Thank you.
Ray Houghton there, Dan. Like, when I think about Jack Charlton, I can always associate one person more than anybody else with the era, and that's Ray Houghton.
Yeah, I suppose it is, you know. Like, it's those two moments, you know, those two goals that you think of, and O'Leary's penalty, I guess, you know. And Packy's save, you know, like, we'll start listing them now. But no, I know what you're saying. And also, I guess that Ray was part of the recruitment policy, you know, the early recruitment policy where, you know, it's a bygone era in the sense that it just wouldn't happen in international football now, that you could almost, you know, a buy one get one free type thing where you go to Oxford and you get Houghton and Aldridge, you know, and they end up being like almost like two signings, you know, in international football, but like two signings making that sort of impact that new signings make in a summer transfer window or something. But yeah, and went on to have such an unbelievable impact. And yeah, look, Ray's so well placed to speak about that side of the character. And there's no doubt. And as Vincent said earlier on as well, he could be blunt. You know, he doesn't suffer fools. But like no good manager doesn't have that. Like you saw Jurgen Klopp being really cranky last week. You know, after Liverpool got thrashed. Like what sustains people in management and you know, in that sort of front line role for so long, you'll find that most of them have an edge of some description. Yeah, they can all be completely unreasonable, belligerent, you know, even unpleasant when they need to be. But like that's why they're there. And I keep going back to it, like, you know, just you make decisions and you have conviction with them. And as much as like, there's no doubt that all the stories, and there's so many countless, you know, private stories that you've heard, and we've heard some of them today about, you know, acts of kindness, you know, away from the sort of the pressure cooker of the gig. But like in the gig, he could be tough, like he could be harsh. I'm sure there was times that people who who loved him, hated him, you know, but that's part of the full rounded, you know, that's the full rounded persona. That's the big personality that he had. And I mean, this is he cut people down at times. I'm sure he was wrong at times, but he was right more times.
Yeah, he was forthright. I remember like the Billy Bingham incident in the Windsor Park. Like he was raging when they had that riot at Lansdowne Road. Against that Egyptian guy in the sideline in USA 94. He could have a short fuse, Jack.
Didn't he make a gesture at Billy Bingham that he regretted as well? Yeah. I think in the heat of the moment after McLaughlin scored, he responded. But I mean, again, like, why do we love football? Like, it stirs emotions. It stirs, like, you know, it leads people to do maybe irrational things, but like that was who he was. And in many respects, you know, we take football so seriously and football debates so seriously, but actually some of the stuff, and you're reading it today about Jack away from football, you know, he was like from working class roots. He was supportive of you know, various, you know, he was almost, you know, he was anti-fascist, you know, he was involved in some sort of, you know, worthy causes, you know, away from the game. He was like, he was from that era. What he, and it's so true. And it struck me from meeting Jack and his wife Pat that time. Like, you know, I'm sure he made more money in the after dinner, you know, circuit post his Ireland career than he ever did in his career. Like, he wasn't from this period of like ostentatious wealth. Like, he wasn't earning much more than the people he was living and working and encountering on a regular basis, and as a result he was completely in touch with people and could relate to people and could talk to people. And listen, I'm not going down generalizing, because you see there's footballers now who do that as well, but there's no doubt, like, he was from a time where, you know, he was still, you know, a Geordie, you know, who had a certain philosophy and mindset that came from his upbringing, and that never left him, even though he was this iconic World Cup figure later in life.
Well, one of the themes I'm kind of taking out of all the conversations with the legends we've had today, Dan, is that he treated people like adults. He treated people like men, and it was no BS. It was just the way it was. And you like it, you like it. If you don't, and I'll try to bring you with me if I can. And this is kind of maybe, you know, this, in the corporate world, that's quite kind of refreshing to hear in ways. Just some text in here on 53106 and some tweets. I wrote a letter to Jack as a 10-year-old thanking him for his work in helping Anglo-Irish relations. I gave it to him at his book signing in Cork in 1996 and thought nothing more of it. 2 months later, I received a handwritten response from Jack. Made my year, and I've been an Ireland mad fan since. That is from Mike. Joe is texting in. Still remember the tears I cried after the Italy game. 1990, the best summer of my life. Can't believe how upset I am today. Jack Charlton did more for Anglo-Irish relations than any Irish person or English person ever. And I'm trying to start a campaign to get a statue of Jack on the Walkinstown roundabout. That is from Mick. Good idea, Mick. We've got Philip Quinn from the Irish Daily Mail on the line. Philip, how are you?
Hello, John. How are you?
Philip, you were on the beach like Vincent Hogan was with Jack. It's a sad day for everybody who is an Irish football fan, an Irish sports fan, and I'm sure you had many memories of liaising, dealing with Jack and having good conversations with him.
Yeah, you say it's a sad day, John, and it is, but it's also a great day of celebration, isn't it? You know, since this morning we've been listening to the radio and following tributes online and on television, and they've all been very... it'll be heartwarming stories, you know, about the man, the manager, the person. So it's a great way of actually celebrating an extraordinary man through his playing career, his managing career, and of course he had a long stint with us. And you know, lots of people have made observations, and Paddy Bonner made one earlier today, which I thought was curious, and it hadn't struck me. But he said that on his travels, he says Jack gets more attention, certainly in Europe, for being what he did for Ireland for 10 years than he did as a World Cup winner with England, which I found extraordinary. But, you know, we regard him as one of our own, but, you know, you can't ignore the Leeds, the 20 years at Leeds, the England caps and that World Cup medal, you know. I mean, that alone was extraordinary. And he was also a pundit. People forget that. He was a pundit in the 74 World Cup and returned to it again in 96. And he had an extraordinarily rich and varied life. And I think Daniel said it earlier, maybe you just said it, he treated everybody the same. Didn't matter whether you were a king, a queen, a prince, or a pauper. You were the same to him. He didn't change to meet you. Some people changed to meet him, but he didn't like that. He was the exact same person all the way through, and that made him what he was, you know. And lots of stories. I mean, you far away. You want to ask me any little sort of
fresh vignettes. I'll throw one or two out.
Well, obviously we're on national radio, Phil. So I'll trust your best judgment. So give us some of the best moments from the Philip Quinn, Jack Charlton days.
Well, I was only a sort of cub reporter when at the first match in 86, and so I first really got known probably in 1994, 1996 period, and yeah, there was a couple of little yarns. I remember in the 94 World Cup, he was very relaxed, and he used to have these press nights, quiz nights in his room, in his big suite in the hotel in Florida, and he invited us up a couple of times, and he was Bamba Gascoigne, he was the quiz master, and he sorted us all into teams, and he'd ask the questions, and he took great pleasure. And he keeps scoring. He got great pleasure when we got a question wrong, and he'd point the finger, "You don't really well know, you're stupid." You know, and Morris Setters was in that room, and he constantly asked Morris Setters the hardest questions out of his little quiz box. And all the way along, he'd be pouring pints, and, "Boy, you look after yourself, get your few pints." And I thought that was sort of a real relaxed sort of way about it. And I know he spoke to a colleague the day before we played Italy, a good colleague of ours and mine, was in his room, whom this colleague he trusted. And he said to him before the game, this is the day before we played Italy, and they're having a couple of pints, and he said, we're buggered. We've no one to play in defence. Moran was injured. McCarthy's obviously retired. Kernahan hadn't come through. And McGrath has had his one shoulder. And he said, we've no chance against the Italians. And he played McGrath, probably against his better judgment, nobody else, and Bab as well. And they had an extraordinary sort of combo, and they played well. And then I remember, after the World Cup, we were playing Northern Ireland in a match in Belfast. And we were staying in the Nuremore. And Jack used to always say, you're allowed into all press, all training sessions. No one's to come over. It was behind closed doors in Oriel Park. And he was up to something. We weren't quite sure what it was. But being resourceful journalists, we had to find out. So we drove across after the team bus had gone. We sort of drove probably on a few unapproved roads, got into the back of Des Casey's field and climbed up, shimmied up sort of a wall. And I remember being able to just peer into the distance into Oriel Park. And I had probably better eyesight than I had now. And I was able to work out he was playing five across the middle with one up front. And Roy Keane was playing wide right because he had the lads in bibs. And I said, it's yellow bibs, it's Keane on the right. So I wrote it in the Indo the next day that Jack was going to play five across the middle and Roy Keane wide on the right. And we were in the Nuremore having breakfast the next morning and he came across and he was tapping the paper angrily against the side of his tie. And he said, you're the Indo? And I said, yeah, I am. He said, did you write this? And I said, yeah, I did. I said, who told you the bloody team? And I said, well, we all have our sources, Jack, you know. And I couldn't let on that I climbed up a wall to see the team. But he was spitting fire and he said, you bloody gun, I'm blowing it now. They know where we're going to play. And he walked away back and the lads were saying, Quinn, that's you. You're jiggered now. He'll never talk to you again. And he came back 10 minutes later and he tapped me lightly on the head. By the way, you were right with the team. I'll give you that soon. And he moved on very quickly. And later that day, or the next day, he actually came over to me and he asked me for a game of golf. Now, Jack fished and he liked a beer and he never played golf. But we went out, we played nine holes in the Nuremore, and he said, we'll play for a fiver. And I knew I'd be in trouble if I won the fiver, because he wouldn't pay me. So we had his little game anyway, and he hit the ball miles, John. He was a big hitter, big athletic man, hit the ball long distances, a little bit ropey around the green. We put up to the ninth hole, and I had a shortish putt to win, and he knew it. He was putting on under pressure. You hold that, you beat me, son. And I duly missed it, and we shook hands, and I was delighted, because had I won, and he'd given me a fiver. That was me in the bad books forever and a day, you know. But look, there were lots of lovely stories, and one last one I'll tell you, John. 25 years after we played Italy in the World Cup, he was invited back to Rome by the Italians. It was a big gig, and he was beginning to get. Was it 25 years or 30? It was 25 years. It would have been yes. It would have been 20. Ooh, what was that? That's 5 years ago. 2015. So he wasn't at his best, and he was. Actually, might have been 20 anniversary. I'll tell you, the manager of Italy was Donadoni, so Daniel can work that one out. It might have been 2010. Anyway, he went across, and he had to ask Peter Byrne, was the colleague of ours who went with him, and he had to be reminded, now, Peter, who am I meeting here? And he said, you're meeting Roberto Donadoni. He's the Italian manager, and he scored the goal that beat us in the World Cup quarterfinals in 1990. That's what, Donadoni, okay, Italian manager, okay. Oh, we beat the World Cup, okay. And then 10 minutes later, Who am I meeting here again? And Peter was very fearful, and people around Jack were fearful that he was going to make a mess of this. You know, that he was going to get it wrong. He was going to embarrass himself. So anyway, they're in the room, fancy room in the Italian Football Federation, and in comes Donadoni, and he doesn't look as he did then. He's probably you know dapper and a bit grey, a bit of stubble, designer stubble, whatever it is. And Jack looks at him, and the lads look at Jack, and Jack gets up and he goes, Roberto! He says, no, he says, yeah, you're the guy with the goal that Packy made a mess of. You hit the shot in, and Packy made a mess of. I remember you, Roberto. Then Adoni says, you're a great player. Packy should have saved your shot, though, by the way. And he managed to carry it off. And the lads were convinced that 10 minutes earlier, he'd forgotten that Donadoni had had the shot. He'd forgotten that the Italian manager. But he was able to turn it around. And even then, he still had a little bit about him. But, you know, I'm just delighted to be able to sort of share one or two yarns. And I think Irish football will look back on this time, and we're all very grateful that we had him.
Philip, go on, Dan. Yeah.
Philip, what was he like with sort of criticism? Like, I know he probably wasn't getting that much, and he obviously had the, you know, like the Dunphy run-ins, and there was, you know, some famous flashpoints there. But, like, we've covered managers in recent years, and, like, Trapp, for example, didn't care. You know, you could say anything about Trapp, and he wouldn't be paying attention. And we've maybe dealt with other managers who maybe Bristol a bit more. Like, how was he? Particularly, I'm thinking towards the end when that last campaign, you know, the Harry Ramsden's challenge and all of that, things went off the rails maybe a bit. Like, how was he when maybe things had to turn a slight bit? Like, how did he take it?
Well, certainly, you're right. In the early days, he didn't care because the results were speaking for themselves. He didn't really read papers. The one paper he read, by the way, was the Daily Mirror. Why? Because he could do the crossword. It was the only paper he ever read. So it didn't matter what you really said. The Dunphy one was interesting because he picked it up wrong, what Dunphy had said, and he shouldn't have done what he did that day, and he regretted that immediately. Later on, yeah, he made mistakes. He did say after the defeat in Vienna, the 3-1 defeat in Vienna, he did say that he had felt his tactics were no longer working and other coaches were coming on the scene and were being a little bit too smart for him and he was going to have to rebuild. And that stage, he was getting criticism, certainly the Harry Ramsden one, that week and that madness in Limerick. And, you know, we were trying to sort of let people know in the papers, and papers were still big then, you know, and they still are now, please God, that this was all wrong. You know, a week on the tear, Jack had gone missing up the north for 3 days, the players were on the raz, and then the Harry Ramsden thing, and Belgian and burping around when they played Austria and running out of juice. But Jack still had this thing that, you know, people said this aura about him. So it was hard to be critical. But we had to point out to the people those days that week he'd got it all wrong. And of course, things fell away, as you know, towards the end of that campaign. He actually, you know what, Danny, he wouldn't have read an awful lot of it. So it wouldn't really have bothered him. But I think looking back on it, we all knew that final year, that final sort of, that week in Limerick, the two games, the Liechtenstein match, the Austria return in Dublin, and then the Austria in Vienna in September. We knew going, and then Portugal. Like it was unraveling, and he didn't need to be told it was unraveling, and a huge rebuild was needed. And you know, he did want to go again. He wanted to go again because a little story there. When we played Holland in '95, the World Cup draw for '98 took place that week while we were there, and I remember he saw the draw and he saw that we were playing, I think, Romania and Lithuania and Northern Ireland. And he went, he says, I think I can build a team and qualify for the World Cup. But the FAI had made the call that as soon as the game was over and we lost 2-0, that the game was up. And he accepted that. He accepted it. But, I think the criticism that he got toward the end reflected the weakening of the grip in the last year. And he would have known himself that he had let things slide.
Well, Philip Quinn, we're delighted to have you on the show today to share your memories about Jack Charlton, and we'll speak to you soon on Off the Ball.
Can I just say a shout, John?
Sure, yeah, of course.
All the best to Dan on the family front.
Okay, great news, Dan. I will talk about that after the break. 53106, your text messages.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power.
It's not quite a TikTok lip sync of Donald Trump, but it's a close second.
Gamble responsibly, cwe.net.
Tech Talk with Jess Kelly.
On the latest Tech Talk, the Deputy Data Protection Commissioner speaks exclusively to me about the HSE's COVID Tracker app. We'll explore how it works, what information it needs, and bust some of the myths that are out there.
Tech Talk with Jess Kelly.
Listen and subscribe to the podcast now, or tune in this evening at 5.
On News Talk. At Renault, we want to be the first to bring you Buy Now, Pay Later. Our new 3-2-1 offer gives you 3 unmissable reasons to buy a new car. 3, that's 3 months real deferred payments. Plus 2, 2.02% APR. Huge savings with Renault Bank. Plus 1, 1,000 euro cashback. Yes, you get all 3. Buy now, pay later from Renault. Visit your local Renault dealer today.
Offer is made under hire purchase agreement, subject to lending criteria. Terms and conditions apply. See Renault.ie.
This summer, have an amazing staycation at Slieve Russell County Cavan, celebrating 30 years when we reopen July 3rd. We can't wait to welcome back families, friends and first-time visitors. And with our 300-acre setting, including Secret Garden and Cranahan Walk, large public areas, golf, kids' clubs, lakes, mountains and more, we bet you can't wait either. Experience all that Ireland's Hidden Heartlands has to offer. Just 90 minutes from Dublin. To book, visit sleeverussell.ie.
Afternoons are easy with InsureMyVan.ie, Ireland's low-cost van insurance specialists. Get your business back on the road with InsureMyVan's best price guarantee. For super savings, visit InsureMyVan.ie. City Financial Marketing Group Limited, training as InsureMyVan.ie, is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
You know that feeling you get when you sense the team's winning streak is about to end? Or when you know the pundits are getting it all wrong? That feeling? That's me. I'm your hunch. I was there back in Istanbul when you just knew the comeback was on. I'm the guy that tells you when the odds don't look so odd. I'm your hunch. It's time to start listening.
Heed your hunch with Betway. Download the app to find out more about Betway's Bet Club. Full terms apply. 18 plus, dunlewy.net. Bet the responsible way.
Local community pharmacies across Ireland have remained open throughout the COVID-19 crisis, putting new measures in place to keep everyone safe and healthy. We would like to thank all our customers for your kindness, cooperation and understanding of the changes we have had to make. What hasn't changed is the quality of care we provide, supplying the medicines you need and the advice you trust. Your local community pharmacy, always here for you. Brought to you by the Irish Pharmacy Union.
The country is on the way to reopening, but the world and our roads have changed since we were last out here. There are now more of us cycling and more of us walking. And there are more reasons to look out for each other. Drivers, please slow down and take care when passing pedestrians and cyclists. Pedestrians, always walk on the footpath. If there isn't one, on the right-hand side of the road facing oncoming traffic. We're on the road back. Make it a safer one. A message from the Road Safety Authority and An Garda Síochána.
The sky's the limit when you're with Three. Our business plans are now half price until 2021. And with truly all-you-can-eat data, you can video call from everywhere, for meetings anywhere. Plus, you'll get the amazing Samsung S20 for free. Visit 3.ie/business or go in-store to switch today and start saving now. Three. Make it count. Selected plans only. Standard monthly charge applies from 2021. Up to 24-month contract applies. All-you-can-eat data. ROI only. See 3.ie.
Escape into nature and rediscover Ireland's great outdoors with the Sunday Independence 25 Best Summer Walks. With loops and trails from Donegal to Kerry to Wicklow, explore Ireland's breathtaking beaches, stunning landscapes and rugged beauty. The Sunday Independent, Ireland's most widely read newspaper. In print or subscribe at independent.ie.
Here's to our local independent businesses. For the last few months, they have been adapting and surviving, finding new ways to serve our communities. At Bank of Ireland, we're doing our bit. And because your financial well-being is our priority, our dedicated business teams can help you take the next step. So we can all keep tapping, clicking and collecting. And one day, getting back to what we all do best. We can, we will, begin. Bank of Ireland is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
At National College of Ireland, our students are living proof that studying here can help boost your career.
I had such a great time at NCI that 9 months after I graduated, I came back and did another course. It was a brilliant decision.
For one thing, I'm sure the MBA was crucial in my getting a big promotion at work.
The lecturers are supportive and engaging, and I think that's really important. That's always a winner in my eyes.
There's a career out there for you after you studied at this college.
Prove to yourself what you can do with our wide range of full and part-time courses at National College of Ireland. Call 1850 221 721 or visit ncirl.ie.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power.
When you've seen West Ham beat Preston in the 1963 FA Cup final for the sixth time, live football is back.
Gamble responsibly. CWE.net.
And you're welcome back to Off the Ball Saturday on News Talk. John Duggan with you 3 to 5 o'clock. We've been paying tribute since 1 o'clock this afternoon to Jack Charlton, the former Republic of Ireland manager who sadly passed away at the age of 85. We've had Kevin Moran, Mick McCarthy, Jason McAteer, John Giles, Kevin Sheedy on the show. You can listen back to all of it if you've missed any of it on the podcast network on the new OTB Sports app. You can download the app now for iOS and Android. Search OTB Sports in the App Store. Dan McDonald from the Irish Independent still with me through to 5 o'clock. Just some texts and tweets, memories from the public, from the listeners across Ireland about Jack Charlton. Jack, RIP. He helped us make a nation great again. A true gentleman, great memories with the dogs in the streets. Even more green jerseys during Italia 90. Dermot Bulger's play in High Germany explains the significance of Stuttgart and all that followed. Phil Lyons in Wexford Town. P.S. My first Irish game was in 1958. Thank you, Phil. Kieran Boyle, listening to memories of Jack in the car here in Florida, reminiscing on Italia 90 and USA 94. What a legend. That is from Kieran Boyle. Looking back at this golden period for Irish soccer, not only did Jack bring us to the top table in world football, but raised the bar and expectations forevermore. I also believe his period as manager helped Ireland stand a foot higher in the world than in the past and help us believe we are a modern country to aspire to. Listening to the contributors, it also shows if you get the culture right, performance follows, something relevant everywhere. On a personal note, due to the final year college exams, I missed the chance to travel to Italia 90, but had a bigger result as I met my future wife on the terraces of Lansdowne Road against Spain in 1989. Thanks for everything, Big Jack, and rest in peace. That is from Paul in Blackrock. Thank you, Paul. I'm part of a group of Crumlin lads who served Jack for 10 years of his term. We were the line side stewards, volunteers on the sideline. Our group was enhanced by Wacker O'Connor, who, like Jack, was a big fisherman. Before every home match, while the team were in the changing room, Jack would come onto the pitch and let a shout out, "Wacker, let's go for a walk." They would then do a lap of the pitch talking about fishing and laughing out loud. I often wonder if this was one of Jack's ways of relaxing before preparing his team for those big games, where we've all got wonderful memories of a great man. Rest in peace, Jack. That is from Jerry McGuigan. We're delighted to be joined on the line now by Mark Lawrenson, the former Republic of Ireland international and Liverpool legend. Mark, how are you?
I'm good, John. Thank you.
Thanks for coming on, Mark. You were part of Jack's first campaign for Euro 88. Unfortunately, you missed the finals through injury, but you would have known Jack well. And did you have a good first meeting with him?
Yeah, well, it was good. What happened was, I think his first game in charge was against the Welsh at home. Yeah. And I'm pretty sure myself, Ronnie Whelan and Jim Beglin couldn't play. I think we might have had a replay or something like that. And so we met at a training camp somewhere the next month. There was no game the next month, and he just wanted to get to know everybody. So we met at this training camp, and we went out to basically practice free kicks, corners, etc., because our three lads, the three Liverpool lads, had been there at the first one. So Jack walks out, got an umbrella all kind of neatly wrapped up and everything, and he said to the players, "Right, show these three, you know, at the free kicks and corners, what we do for and against." So the guys put this on and everything, and me, Jim, and Ronnie are watching. And I was just looking at Jack. He was behind the goal with his back to us, practicing his goal swing with his umbrella. Anyway, after about 15, 20 minutes, John, I just shouted. I said, "Jack, we're done." He says, "Good." He says, "Can you all three remember?" And of course, we lied to him and said, "Yeah, of course we can." He went, "Right, let's get on with training." And that was him. He was obviously making a point in a particularly nice way. He was kind of saying, "This is what we did with all the lads. They all know all about it. And if you three want to play for me, you've got to know all the stuff." So that was good. It was great. And I think the thing with him, of course, we know that basically Bob Paisley should have got the job in terms of the way the voting was organised. But when you really think about it, John, the right man got the job, not maybe in the right way, but certainly was the right man for the time.
He was you were a league winner with Liverpool. You know, you won everything in the game. You won a European Cup. Did you adjust to it quickly?
Yeah, I mean, the lads then told me when we were having this, when we had this meeting, they told me that, "Oh, wait till you speak to Jack," because they said he's told all the back four players that they can't come out and play with the ball. They've got to play in the opposition half. I thought, "Oh, crikey, this is going to be great." And after we'd had this session that I just was saying to you there, he said to me, I don't see you playing at the back for me. He said, "I want you to play in midfield in the kind of holding role." And I said, "Does that mean I can play with the ball?" He said, "Only in the opposition half." So, yeah, listen, it was just the way that he was. I think what I will say, obviously, you know, because of the granny rule, we had some really, really good players. And I played for Giles. Johnny was a player manager. Then Owen Hand as well. And we'd always had decent players. We just lacked a little bit of organisation as much as anything, John. And Jack gave it to us. I mean, it wasn't a massive fan when we first started the way that we played. But once you start winning and you get some results and you suddenly think, you know what, with the group of players we've got, this is the best way we can go about winning. You soon got used to it, and we all really seriously bought into it. And you know, he never said a great deal to me, Jack. He just go and play as you play for Liverpool and all those kind of things. But it was great with everybody. He didn't suffer fools. He didn't give you a picture which was full of grey areas. It was like, you know, this is the way we play. This is black. This is white. On you go. And listen, you know, won the World Cup. We've managed teams. Sheffield Wednesday, etc., Newcastle, I think, Middlesbrough as well. So he knew what he was at, but it was very, very uncomplicated. But John, once you start winning and getting results, and then, you know, the quality of our players got even better as well, and all of a sudden we're looking around thinking, crikey, we've got a really, really good team here.
Mark, if I could just come in there, like, yeah. the Hampden Park win, which is like this... for years it was a reference point. Like, the last time Ireland had a big win away from home was this game against Scotland, who were the top side then. Because I think that day, was it Ronnie Whelan and Paul McGrath, fullbacks, and you were in the set. What do you remember about that? Because it's obviously a famous night.
Well, he named the team. I can't remember what we played. We were playing at Hampden on the Tuesday before the Wednesday, and he named the team, and, you know, packing goal, and then he went right back, Paul McGrath, and then I think Kevin Moran and Mick, the two centre-backs, and he went left back, Ronnie Whelan. And I just happened to catch his eye, Ronnie Whelan, and I looked at him, he's like, he gave me old WTF, you know, and then he's gone. He said, Mark, you're playing centre midfield, which I knew anyway, and I haven't told anybody. I kept that sort of quiet. And it was that kind of, when he named the whole 11, there's this kind of hush. And he just sort of went, all right. And, yeah, all right, Jack, yeah, all right, right, thanks very much indeed. But it worked. And, I mean, you know, I was lucky enough to score the goal that night. And then later on in the game, it was still 1-0, I tried to score a second. And I'm sure you've heard the story before, but there was only a couple of minutes left. And so we win 1-0, and Jack comes sort of semi-running and jogging and walking over to me. And everybody thought he came round to put his arm around my shoulder and say, you know, what a goal and all that kind of stuff. He gave me the biggest bollocking ever. He just said to me, why are you trying to score a fucking goal? And he said, well, I thought it was on. He said, never, ever, ever do that again in my team. And I went, okay, boss, no problem.
Would it even surprise you, though, Mark, how high it went? Euro 88, World Cup 1994. You've been involved in the team. I know you're injured by that stage and you retired, but you were involved in the team since the 70s.
Well, it was. I was going to say a roller coaster, John. It wasn't a roller coaster. It was just like a Manhattan on a chart. It was just going up and up and up. And, you know, and this was the thing about, you know, the fact it was like the tactics were so, so simple. But, boy, every player we played in the teams that you just mentioned in the competitions didn't half work hard for him. They really, seriously, they loved playing for him. He treated you as men. He let you have a drink when it's time to have a drink. As I say, never fill your brain with rubbish. It was all just very obvious, very, very easy, all those kind of things. And he was just very, very easy to work for and also to play for. And once you start, you know, winning games, and once you start qualifying and you look around, because we know it had been the Holy Grail and we'd really, really struggled and quite often fell at the last hurdle, but all of a sudden you get this confidence, and, you know, you'd be in the dressing room, even in my short time with him, and you look around and you think, you know, now we've got an absolute sort of nailed-on pattern of play. You look around the dressing room and think, it's going to be a good team that's going to beat us, by the way, when you looked at some of the players that we had.
Yeah, it's as some people have said on the show today, Mark, it's a sad day, but also maybe a day to celebrate with a soft drink or a socially distant drink later on. A man who the country loved here.
Yeah, listen, everybody loved him. I think even all the players that played for him, as I mentioned, the teams at Sheffield Wednesday and Newcastle and also, where else did we say that he played? At
Middlesbrough.
I can't remember the other one. Anyway, but even the ones he probably left out the side, you just couldn't help but like him. And I have this thing, which and it is a quiz question that not many people know, but they probably do now because I've been telling everyone today, was I am the only person ever to play for a Jack Charlton team and a Bobby Charlton team. So I quite like that.
Brilliant. Mark Lawrenson, thanks so much for joining us today.
Pleasure.
Mark Lawrenson there, the Liverpool legend and former Republic of Ireland international. Dan, we're nearly there to wrap it up. It's been a show we didn't expect to be doing this morning. And then the news came out that Jack had passed, and we've heard from a lot of legends over the last 4 hours. And it's a sad day, but also a day to remember a man who changed the nation. And I will say that, and people might not agree with me, but definitely changed people's lives in certain ways.
Definitely. You know, listen, I don't think that's a wrong thing to say. Like, you can debate the depth of it, but there's no doubt that there's something true. Like, when you have that reference point that we can all, you know, relate to. And even, I was playing football earlier with a bunch of lads, a lot of them wouldn't remember, they'd be younger. But like, they know it through their parents or whoever, you know, whoever. Like, we love nostalgia in this country. We've got reeling in the ears on all the time. And like, during this lockdown in particular, and what's been a pretty difficult year, we've naturally drawn on happier memories, like to nearly get you through some of the days. Like, we've done it here, and I would make no apologies for doing it. And like, in our sporting history, when we want that happiness, when we want to like think of that better time, nothing will come close to the memories that his team created. Nothing. I don't think it will subsequently either. And as a result, you know, I don't feel bad about labouring the point a bit. It was like a very special time in our history, and we can only be grateful for it and like send our best wishes to everyone. But I think, you know, whenever people get together to remember his life, there'll be more laughter than tears, I think.
Yeah, well done, Dan. Well said. And we'll speak to you soon on Off the Ball Saturday.
Cheers, John.
Dan McDonald there. We've had a great tribute, I think, to Jack Charlton today. I think this is all about belonging. I think that Jack Charlton made people feel that they belonged in this country to something. This magical mystery tour, this movement that we never knew when the end and the beginning was. We never knew where we go. And we went to great places, Germany, Italy 90, USA 94. And it's a tribute that we're going to be hearing more of on Off the Ball over the week, on tomorrow's show and through the rest of the week. And we do hope you enjoy the last few hours as we reflect on a very sad day about the passing of Jack Charlton. Don't forget, tomorrow on Sunday's show, Joe Molloy will be in the chair from 1 o'clock just to recap on some of the scores today. Norwich 0, West Ham 4, Watford 2, Newcastle 1. It's Liverpool 1, Burnley 1, entering the closing stages in the match at Anfield. Now, as well as contributing our tributes to Jack Charlton, continuing them, I will bring you live and exclusive commentary of the North London Derby between Spurs and Arsenal from the New White Hart Lane. Stephen Doyle and Brian Kerr calling the shots. Be sure to tune into that. If you missed any of our tributes to the late great Jack Charlton this afternoon, you can find the podcast of the whole show on our brand new OTB Sports app. Search OTB Sports in the App Store for iOS and Android. Thanks for listening to us today on what is a sad day for the nation. We'll finish with this tribute that Nathan Murphy made for us about Big Jack. And may Big Jack rest in peace. Bye-bye.
We've had some great days and great nights and good memories. I hope that the people of Ireland have got... I know that they've got the memories. I know they cherish them, and I know that they've enjoyed the days that when they've done something that they've never done before. They go to a World Cup as part of it a couple of times. They've enjoyed that. And the European Championship.
Thank you for the days. Those endless days, those sacred days you gave me.
President phoned me and said, "Would you like the job is yours if you'd like it?" And I said, "I would like it." End of story.
I won't forget a single day, believe me.
Well, you know, we're 28-1, I think, we're quoted as, and we're not expected to do anything in this competition. We just hope to surprise a few people.
This kick by Sanselin goes Aldridge, and Houghton! 1-0!
Nowadays, you see, they've changed it. Everybody in Europe does a little bit of what we did. Everybody in Europe. But they've changed the name, the FIFA guys. They call it pressing. Because they don't want to tell us that we started it. We call it putting people under pressure.
Malta 0, Republic of Ireland 2. And history has been made in Malta. Jack Charlton achieving his victory. Achieving his ambition.
We've qualified for the Go to Italy, and we've done it ourselves. I'm absolutely delighted, not only for me, for our lads and for all the fans.
The nation holds its breath. Yes, we're there!
And then I saw David come in, and I'm not the greatest believer in centre-backs taking penalties. And then David went back, put the ball down again, and went, sent the goalkeeper on way and put it in, and it went fantastic.
We're there. We're in the last eight for the first time in my history, and it's magic. I'm delighted for the lads. And good luck to the people back home. Right. Hope they have a good part.
Burton came to me, and he said, our boss, he said, when we get to Rome, this you'll get us in to see the Pope, won't you? Well, that was where the final was going to be played, and I don't think they'd have prayer again for the final.
Right.
We prepared properly. We had a little bit of strength. We ate well. And we drank very little. We're going to change that tonight.
It's a bit like religion, isn't it? And football's a bit like religion, isn't it? And Jack's. He'd be like a sort of, he's supposed to be like a pope or a bishop or something.
He would.
But easy, onto it comes Hope, and Hope with a shot, and it's there!
I went into the players and we just sat in the dressing room and we were getting changed and everything, and then somebody come and said to me, would you come out back on the pitch? I said, what for? He said, the crowd won't go home. I just remember, I just cried. It was time for me to leave. I'd been there for 10 years, and it was time for me to leave. And I did.